Welcome to the Town of Deerfield Board of Selectmen's meeting. I'm here at the Town Hall offices in the Village of South Deerfield on February 24th, 2016 at 6:35. First order of business is Marty. Welcome.
Hey. I just wanted to read a brief statement,
sure,
if I could, and then I'll introduce our guests. So thank you for inviting us to speak to you tonight regarding the Deerfield Elementary roof. As you know, the elementary roof was originally constructed in 1992, or 24 years ago. The current roof is original to the building. Knowing that a roof replacement was imminent, the school committee began several years ago to vote money into a stabilization fund in an effort to offset the costs. While that fund is woefully short of the entire cost of the project, it was an important symbolic gesture to do each year as a continuing reminder that the roof was nearing the end of its life cycle and would need to be replaced. Because we had completed another MSBA project in Conway with some success, we determined that we should try again to take advantage of this program for the Deerfield Elementary School. Therefore, a year and a half ago, we began the application process to see if we would be accepted into the accelerated repair program. We were pleased to be accepted with a 52% reimbursement rate. The pictures that you see rotating on the screen represent the damage that has occurred inside and outside of the building. Much of it last year, but some of it even from this year. We are fortunate that this has been a mild winter. Many of the damaged areas have been repaired. In addition, many of the leaks at the eaves or edges of the roof and the water still drips down the windows and the metal window frames. While this does not show well in the pictures, the classroom rugs have also gotten saturated. Many have had to have been replaced, and this is a particular concern as this is where mold inside the walls and carpeting can be harbored. It is important to stress that the existing roof shingles are brittle and beginning to fail. There have been many leaks that have occurred in the tabs of the shingles where there is only one layer of coverage. Again, we cannot stress enough how fortunate we have been this year, and I know it's pouring tonight, to have mild weather thus far. If we had had a winter like last year, there would have been far greater damage this year, and it will only continue to get worse. Just so that you're aware, the last day of school for us right now is looking like June 13th, which is a Monday. It will be a half day. That's if we have no further snow days. I would hope that construction begin the week of June 20th. If we delay school opening until after Labor Day, that would give us 11 weeks of construction. We have moved all of the summer programming to other schools in the district, so there will be minimal foot traffic in the building. So that's just basically an overview to kind of get people as up to speed as to where we are. And I think the next person to speak is going to be Kelly Claffey, and she's going to talk about the MSBA process. And then Jeff Yost has some designs and some things that he's going to impart to us, too. So
thank you, Marty. Yep. Marty made a preface to the MSBA. So that stands for Massachusetts School Building Authority, for those who don't know. And it was created in 2004 to assist local communities like yourself for affordable, sustainable, and energy-efficient schools across the state of the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. MSBA was a mandated result of the Construction Reform Act of 2004 as well. The Accelerated Repair Program, MSBA randomly appoints pre-qualified OPMs like myself and my firm and designers like Jeff and his firm from a list of pre-qualified firms. They go through an arduous process to pre-qualify such firms and have a pool from a list. And for these accelerated repair programs, we are picked and randomly appointed. And then obviously the towns have the right to vote yes or no if should they not like who is chosen. But the accelerated repair program primarily focuses on roofs, windows, doors, and boilers. And obviously, our project is a roof repair. The projects are deemed eligible for reimbursement. Like Marty prefaced, we are 52.06 of eligible cost is reimbursable, and there is a matrix of eligible costs that we've gone over in the past meetings. And Pink and Company is tasked to track those, report on those. The MSBA has a highly prescriptive program of, you know, checks and balances and reporting that has to happen for the life cycle of the project. So it's just a little bit of an overview on the MSBA and the program that we're a part of. Just to give you a little bit of an idea of Pink and Company and what we do, we are, like I said, an owner's project manager. We oversee the project from the feasibility study, which happens very early on in the commencement of the kickoff of a project, all the way through the closeout, financial closeout documentation, and so on. We oversee the project schedule, the budget. We ensure that the project is completed as we said and planned it was going to be completed and per the MSBA guidelines. We review and track the project expenses and all the MSBA paperwork, as we've stated. Review the design and construction and contract documents, which we've been very much a part of with RDA through the last couple months here, with the schematic moving to the 60% drawings, moving to then construction drawings next. And we'll provide a clerk of the works. Again, we've collaborated with the town officials to make sure that clerk of the works is the right person for this project. Pink and Company, we've been established in a firm since 1998. We provide value-driven project management services for nonprofit and the public sector owners, again, from concept to closeout. We've had a Western Mass office since 2013, and that's been established, and we've been doing several different projects out of that office since then. And we've said we're down the street here at the South Deerfield practice building a new doctor's office for everybody. So hopefully if one of you go to any of those, you can go there too. But we are pre-qualified to serve as an OPM in the MSBA ARP projects that we talked about. We've done about a dozen of the MSBA ARP projects since 2009. So we are very well vetted in the process and have that have this process down. The team from Pink and Company is myself, Alicia Tony, who's our project director, Tommy Chan, who's assistant project manager. I'm the project manager, and then we'll have the clerk of the works as well. So, hand it over to Jeff, RDA.
Thank you for having me tonight. My name is Jeff Yost with Raymond Design Associates. Our firm, Raymond Design Associates, has been in business for approximately 10 years. In that time, Gene and I have actually had a working relationship over 20 years. And with that, we have done some 40 plus MSBA types of schools, from new construction, renovation, and roof replacement, window replacement, even boiler replacement. On the MSBA accelerated program, we've done 10 roofs. This is our second time around with the state MSBA. We go in 3-year groupings where we do it for 3 years with them, and then we up again and get pre-qualified again. It's not once, you just don't do it once, you do it over a period of time. We've been very successful. We've brought all our projects in on budget. And the closest one that we've done that we worked with was in Northampton. We had two roofs there, the Leeds School, and my apologies.
Was it the middle school?
Yeah, and the middle school. And those were roof replacements. Going to the design, wanted to talk to you about the existing conditions. We were selected as the architect by MSBA to come out and do a survey and work with the town of the existing conditions. From those existing conditions, we developed as a design. What we found in the existing conditions was that basically the shingle has come to its lifespan. It was a 25-year asphalt shingle that was installed, and you know, it's showing signs of wear. brittleness, breakage, and you can see on the screen there that, you know, they're starting to experience leaks within the building. What we're proposing to do is to the deck system that is there has insulation along the rafter line, and we have done an infrared test to identify the wet areas. We're going to replace those areas with insulation and new board in those areas, and then add additional insulation. We're going to do a vented nail board that is going to significantly help us reduce the amount of ice dams that the school is experiencing. Right now it's a compact or a hot roof design. We're going to do a vented roof design on that, so that you have a level of cold air right at the shingle line that will basically minimize and reduce significantly the ice damming. With that, we are specifying a higher grade shingle. It's a 40-year shingle by CertainTeed as our basis of our design. We have other ones that are similar. You know, per the state requirement, we have to have three manufacturers that all do the same thing with the shingles. But this is a 40-year shingle. What we also heard from the group when we were doing our design, shingles are slightly different than membrane roofs, flat roofs. Shingles are a prorated. After 7 years, it starts getting prorated, and it's only the material. And where a membrane roof is full warranty, goes from between 20 and 30 years, depending on what you purchase. We were asked to see what kind of enhancements we can do with the warranty. We're specifying a five-star warranty that provides includes labor, disposal, damage to any shingles, whether it's workmanship or manufacturing, for 25 years. And so,
On the shingles.
And so that's included in this design. It's included in the cost estimate. And so then after that, then it goes into the prorating. But what we're guaranteeing is a level of quality of installation with this five-star enhanced warranty. The other thing that we're adding here is insulation. There was 3 inches of ISO insulation. And we need, per MSBA, we have to meet the stretch code, the state energy code there. And so we have increased that to an R25. So there's going to be improvements in your energy loss. Okay.
Does that affect the snow load?
Excuse me?
Does that affect the snow load? Because a lot of these roofs were designed like this one, for the heat to go out and it melts the snow and it, you know, comes off.
When I looked at the drawings, which part were you asking whether it affects the snow?
Well, the additional insulation, it keeps it from, you know, the heat from escaping, so the snow doesn't actually melt.
Right.
Does that affect, I mean, is that, like, we couldn't do that here because it's not designed to hold the snow and the...
Right, where that roof right there is a 5 and 12, and the structural engineer of that period when he designed the building designed for the snow load, and it actually called for the snow drifts in his calculations.
Okay.
And so, you know,
so not having so much, you know, not having the heat escape is not going to be negative. Okay.
No,
that's
not,
what I just said.
And what we're trying to do is minimize the melting, you know. With what was there, I'm going to describe it very simply. You got your sloped roof, and you got your wall right here. And there was very little insulation at the heat point as it was traveling up from the perimeter heat and was creating ice there, and then it was melting down. What we're going to try to do is we're going to reduce that significantly.
Okay.
On that.
Okay. Great.
But to answer your question, there's so much snow that can be on that roof, and we have to manually remove it if it hits the level of which the snow can be. And that's not going to change any because it's not changing the structure of the roof.
That's correct. It was designed for that, and I believe you had brought in engineers, and I have paperwork that said that between 12 and 18 inches you need to consider removing that and maintaining that maintenance on that.
Mm-hmm. I think that's what we've done, right? I mean,
no, we haven't. That's the reason we're in the mess we're in.
Oh. But I thought that's when part of the Dick, other, I thought Dick
Dick forced out. It, but over yeah. the past number of years, nobody's really looked at it in a meaningful
okay.
way, so
yeah.
that when you get that amount of snow and the drifting, it creates that ice dam capability, which increases both your weight and it also increases the backup possibilities because
that's
it's,
correct,
because
it's a dam right at
so
the end.
If we don't maintain it and pay attention to that, you know, foot to 18 inches, we're basically setting up for failure, and that's part of the reason the roofs are brittle. The sunlight's the major reason, but if you get ice in there and it freezes, it separates the material. It's
okay.
not designed to stretch and bend with ice.
The ice works up capillary action up the shingle, melts, starts separating, and that's where you get your damage.
You get damage to it. So a lot of the damage, that roof should have been good for, you know, they say it was at 25 years. I'm not going to get into, but it should, if treated properly and done correctly, should have gone beyond that. There are roofs out there that basically are now on 30, 35 years on a 25-year roof. But it's maintenance that's going to make the difference in there.
Okay.
Just a quick question. Could we please repeat the guarantee on that roof as far as materials, labor, and
My understanding is it's a 5-star rating that will be a 25-year guaranteed, even though it's a 40-year shingle. It's guaranteed and then prorated after the 25-year period. And it's replacement, shingles, and everything else. Is that correct, Jeff?
Yes. So what it is, it also, within that guarantee, why we say it's a 5-star, we're the manufacturer is then requiring that it's a certified installer of that product who has done that stuff before. And so it's a whole level. It's just not, there's, you know, we're buying a warranty. We're also buying craftsmanship and workmanship mm-hmm. in that warranty to get
does
you
that
there.
Does that cover labor also?
Yes, it does. Even disposal.
Okay.
You know, they had a 3-star, a 4-star, and a 5-star. And I believe the 5-star was the best suited for this project, mm-hmm. which included the disposal. You know, that's one thing is you want to make sure you cover all your bases there.
Right.
How much?
So any issues within that 25-year period?
You pick up the phone. Yes.
Just have to pick
workmanship
up the phone.
And manufacturers, you know, manufacturing.
Right.
You know, usually the on a regular prorated shingle, if you don't buy that warranty, it's a manufacturer's warranty of manufacturing of
correct.
The shingle. It's not the workmanship.
Yeah.
You know, and so and it doesn't include the labor.
Right.
All right.
So this includes labor, workmanship.
Correct.
Materials for 25 years.
Yes, it does on the 5-star.
Okay, and disposal if
right.
need be.
And it's prorated out to 40 years after that.
Correct.
And what that is like, for example, that same shingle, if it was residential, it's a lifetime, but on a commercial building, that's the extent that they'll allow you to do.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
If I may, could I ask a question?
Sure.
My understanding is when going out for public bidding, you can't specify a brand name?
We do a basis of design.
Okay.
And we base it around that manufacturer. And
okay.
then we list acceptable manufacturers that can do that work also.
Okay.
And
yeah.
so that's how we do that.
Okay. So it was leading into my question that are there a number of manufacturers that offer similar warranties?
Yes. Like GAF and Temco.
Okay. So at least two.
Yes.
Fair enough. Thanks.
Mm-hmm.
Question?
Yes.
Who has the right of refusal as far as materials? Some shingle companies have run into some issues recently.
They don't get the IKOs and they don't have a product that meets the specification. That's like
okay.
the only way to make them go away.
All right.
I think to answer your question too, we've been working hand in hand with Richard,
mm-hmm.
and he has a certain shingle that he would like to see. But obviously, you can't just do one in
right,
the public bidding sector.
I was just
sector.
Wondering who had that
yes,
right
but,
of refusal if that became an issue.
Well, we've also. The thing that we have here is also we're specifying a level of shingle that has a double glue tap.
Mm-hmm.
It's designed, they call it 110 mile an hour wind
right.
level. And so we're specifying a high-performance shingle to start off with.
Okay.
And
is
right,
it,
go ahead.
Is it simple for you guys to do a calculation and say, well, if this is going to cost X amount of dollars, and we'd like to do exactly what you're saying, but get rid of the shingles and go to a standing seam option, is it, how much does it cost to find out what that costs?
We did that analysis a while back, and there was conversations on the pros and cons of each of those. And I don't have the cost data in front of me, but there was performance issues. You know, the school was, the roof was designed to hold the snow, wasn't designed to allow the snow to come off of it. And so, you know, and it sort of answers to the snow loads there. It was designed for that. We also saw that it was the same.
Like, I just think personally, and I'm not a politician, I make a decision for the town, but personally, dealing with snow falling on children, we could figure out a way to make that not happen. And I nail shingles to roofs for a living. I know every single shingle you're speaking of, they don't perform as well as the piece of paper they give. I'm certified as all of the installers too. Like, I know what all of what you're speaking about on that end means, but it's apples and oranges comparing it to, if you shingle that roof, I might still be alive to shingle it again and actually be capable. If you put a stand and seam on it, I'll be dead before the roof fails.
And I'd like to, for clarification, I read through the original design proposal, and the, although they talked about how much additionally it would cost to have a standing seam roof put in place per square, it never gave us a starting point. It never told us what the shingle costs were going to be. So when I dug through it trying to get an understanding of really what the costs were going to be, I couldn't get it out of the report. So if you could give me that information, I'd be interested in it, just for
standing seam cost versus shingle cost.
Yeah,
per square foot.
For the labor, at least. I'm interested in what you're going to scope it out as. He's interested in labor. I want to know what the difference for the
yeah,
project.
I can do that.
Be.
I can provide that for you. I believe we have that in some of our documents. I just need to find it for you.
I was just going to say, I think you did it, and it was tremendously more expensive, wasn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
I read the documents, and there was no jumping off point.
I do think we did it early on.
We did it early on in our decision during the schematic design level. So let me get that information for you.
I read the documents that went back to November, October period that gave the schematic design evaluation that you had the engineering component of, and their group came up with the comparison, but it didn't give me a starting point. I couldn't, you know, I read it over three or four times. I couldn't get a starting point. They gave me how much difference it would be probably for standing seam and for multi-layer membrane roofing and the pros and cons of the whole nine yards, but I couldn't get out of that. So if you get me that would be great.
Yes.
The five-star rating that we're paying for, I assume that they're not giving that to us with the shingles because of, is there a premium that we pay for that?
Yes,
that five
there
star
is
rating
a premium.
If I could have that information sent to Doug, that would be great.
When I talked to the representative, the premium portion, the true premium fee portion, I think is, excuse me if I'm incorrect, but it's, I believe it's between 10 and 15,000. But where a lot of that warranty is applied to is in workmanship, the proper nailing, and the certified installer doing that. And so those are where you gain that five-star warranty. Basically, it's about 10 to 15,000. It might be a little less, but that's the range it was.
Okay. Can you get, if you're wrong, could you get that to Doug?
I'm gonna provide you both.
That would
okay?
be great. Question back?
I can get that.
Okay.
Buy that at the supply house. Like, it's
that
easy.
Send it to Doug. Sorry for interrupting your presentation.
Okay.
With the question, so.
To finish it, or I'm going to jump around a little bit. Basically, we have approximately about 80,000 square feet of shingle replacement and approximately about 4,000 square feet of membrane roof replacement in the design. And so when I did do those, I did talk to the CertainTeed rep on that and asked them all those questions that you're asking me, and I can get you that information that relates to what the premium was. I know that, I remember him saying it's 8, but I'm going to say between 10 and 15 for this size project is what he was talking about, and I can get you that.
Any more presentation?
I believe that's it.
So,
Mark, did you have anything you wanted to finish up on, just relating the fact that it's our asset? It's, you know, we have to do something to.
Yeah, I'm, and that's why I appreciate the opportunity tonight, because I think the important piece is that we have a roof that's failing. This is the town building that houses small children, and we want to maintain our asset. We thought this was the best way to go after it and minimize the cost to the town, rather than just going out and having the town incur the entire cost of the roof. I know MSBA was started because, frankly, there had been some shams in the state years ago, and shams may not be the right, but people who misrepresented themselves. And this gave a set of standards so that you had architects and you had builders and designers who had to be properly vetted in order to, I'm not a roofer, I don't know, I'm a lay person, and so you need experts who can help guide you through this. So we have a debt override coming up. I'm hoping that people will come out and vote for it. Because
it's a debt exclusion.
Debt exclusion. Sorry, yeah, I know the word override.
You can have a real debt exclusion stampede vote, if you don't use the right terminology.
Say that
I apologize.
Again. Debt exclusion vote, because otherwise the entire cost will be borne by the town. Okay. But it's really important. I remember when that elementary school was constructed. Part of our pledge as townspeople would be that we'd maintain.
Okay.
Property.
And I'm going to try as politically correct to say this, because the part is that I don't think there's anybody in this room or anybody that's probably of a sound mind that doesn't know that we have to do something
right
to fix it. And I think we all want the best thing for our children, mm-hmm. and we want, you know, the best environment for them to learn and everything else. But that being said, we didn't maintain it. We as a town, and I'm not pointing mm-hmm. fingers at anybody, we as a town did not maintain the building to make sure that it... I got somebody who wants to interrupt my speech.
You don't have to maintain a roof. Like, you just put one on, and then it goes bad, and you do it again. We didn't do the best job first. I think we need to... The plans of insulating and all of that is great. I just can't understand why we're going to tackle that battle and then put an asphalt shingle roof on top of it. It's kind of like building a $50,000 garage to put your Kia in. And if the infrared pictures, how do we see those?
I have sent those to Bob Lesko.
Okay.
So he has them.
Yeah.
And we had a full survey of the roof.
Okay.
And they identified the wet areas.
Yeah.
And where the areas of heat loss and wet insulation were.
Okay. And those are somewhere where, like, us townspeople can see them?
Well, you just have to...
Sure. You could just contact... contact my office.
Yeah.
And
I definitely know the school needs a new roof.
Mm-hmm.
And my daughter goes there. I just don't want to see the town. They could have, if there could be a better option. I just don't like
it. I think you will get the information on the metal seamed roof.
Okay. And if I can finish. And I stand corrected. It's
you don't maintain the roof itself, you maintain the building that has the negative things happening to it while water pouring
right,
inside.
Yeah, I mean, if you
and things of that nature.
Shoveled it before the ice dams got that bad. But we, I think you need to make that go away. And his plan.
And I agree, and where I'm going with this is the fact that we're going to make the commitment, we're going to actually have us fixing it before it requires us to, because the shingles, I can't speak to them. I can't say they would make 30 years. I know that some of them have made 30 years and longer. But if we had done the preventive maintenance, we might not have been facing
this
for a while.
On this roof, shingles are going to last a lot longer than on the school. I mean, you're asking, they're on a low-pitched roof there. You're not going to get the full life expectancy out of a roof. And with the courtyards, it has a lot of areas of that roof that just get tested a lot more than the typical roof.
The typical roof? Okay. So, I have a couple other questions if somebody else doesn't at this point.
No, go ahead, Mark.
We were told that we had the option to be part of the selection of the clerk of the works and could have voted it down. Was that just the building committee that had that option to do it?
No, sir. We've collaborated with Dick to get a list of names who he may recommend. I don't feel like I said the select board with the town.
Well, you said the town, and I want to know
my apologies.
That relies because someone asked me about it early on, and my gut feeling is that when you have a lot of chiefs watching an Indian put something in place, there's a lot of people to deny any responsibility for what went wrong with the exception of the Indian, and that's the one's going to get landed on. Right. So if I got people watching people, they can all go, well, they didn't watch correctly, they didn't do this correctly. I want to minimize the number between the people that designed it and said this is what we're going to do and the people that put it on place, because I want to know who did it wrong. I don't want, well, it might have been, and I have personal experiences with the school, the elementary school, when it was first put up, and there were a lot of engineering or architectural failures in it, and we're experiencing one now. One was the sprinkler system, in which I was bailing water for quite a while, and I had a few children that caught a window in the eye because they happened to think it was a really good idea to put a jalousie window in the middle of a walkway. Nobody was held responsible. I'm going to say right now, people are going to be held responsible because basically I'm going to start making sure that the documentation of the words are there so that when somebody comes back and says, who did this wrong? I want to be able to say, this is what we were told, and basically it didn't follow through.
Because I think Dick has screened all the...
Yes, ma'am. Yes. Dick has screened every single one.
Okay.
There's
but
three.
Again, we're putting more Indians in the way, we're putting more chiefs in the process of getting something accomplished, and that just come from an industry that has lots of chiefs and very few workers.
I think the clerk would be an Indian because he or she would be on site daily in the mix and have, again, it's this prescriptive process with MSBA where you have to report back to them. Otherwise, the layman, you know, we don't get paid. We have to prove what we're doing throughout the process, and that is an Indian working day to day. That Indian is an oversight Indian.
So let's just talk a little bit about the construction process. I think so that everyone's clear is that there's levels of chiefs, you know, at the designer side, the OPM side, and actually on the state side. We're going to be coming out weekly and doing administrating the dockets, making sure that they are installing them correctly. We are going to require that they do a mock-up on the roof for the installation of, so that we follow that all the way through. You know, no more stacking shingles. We're going to do a pyramid shape. That's what part of your problem is. You can see all the lines going up because they did call them installations. you know, and those joints are telegraphing through, and those are where the cracks are. We're going to do a pyramid shape here. We're going to make sure that we have the proper installation there. With that, the clerk is our eyes and ears on a daily basis to make sure that they're following the process. They're beyond a clerk. They are an owner's representative that can, at some level, make decisions and call, whether it's the designer or the project manager for that. In addition to that, the state has their own commissioning agent who actually provides design materials within my specifications that I put out that talk about, you know, the level of quality. They do their own walkthroughs along the process of construction, and they provide punch lists and field reports to follow.
So I guess the point is there's checks and balances to whether it's a chief or an Indian throughout the process that MSBA directs, and we all have to follow on behalf of your town.
Forgive me for labeling or putting it in process. We have a whole litany of people going to make sure this gets done correctly. But what I want is to make sure that every single one of them is held accountable for this project, not just the person that installed it or the person that designed it, but everybody in the middle there, because basically, instead of having the opportunity to water down the responsibility, I think it's owned by everybody there, and I'm going to go on record of saying that this is something that needs to be understood up front, is that everybody there is as responsible as everybody else, whether it's the chief or the Indians or anybody. But I've lived the dream of having all these people in place across the gamut, and it usually ended up with a whole bunch of people in the middle that said, well, you know, it's somebody else's responsibility.
Right.
I don't want to... That's my point. And whether they're a chief or an Indian or a high-paid salary, whatever, the reality is we have, in your organization alone, we have four tiers of management people making sure that a roof, you know, I put a few roofs on in my day, so I know what putting a roof on is. Sure. I know how to put insulation on, and I think I could probably figure out the schematics and plans. However, I ain't going to do that roof. But there's a lot of management there. The last thing I want to see is them escape the thought process that basically there's enough layers so that they're not going to be called. Jeff?
Yes, residents spend $3 million for this roof. I think what we'd be looking for upon completion of that roof, I think we'd be looking for one telephone number. One telephone number, so if that roof is leaking or moving or shingles coming off, you dial that one number and you speak to whoever that person is, this is what the problem is, come out, take a look at it, and fix it, make it work. And the town should be able to walk away and make sure that that repair will be done, no questions asked. The town shouldn't be chasing around to 10 different sections as far as architect, who installed it, the company that materials were from. That's not the town. That town should not be doing that. The town should have one telephone number to pick up the phone, make that call, and have that, whatever the case may be, have it taken care of in the conversation.
Okay.
Then that's how I feel about it.
I'm
agreeing with you back 100%. Yeah. There's got to be accountability if we're spending $3 million.
And that's the point. The second part of that is, we've gone through a lot of iterations over the last 3 weeks, and I've heard he said, she said issues across, so it's whose fault for why it's being delayed, what's happening, or whatever. I went out of my way to make sure that before we left our last vote, that everybody understood that we would fund the rest of what needed to go until March 11th. I want to say that if there's another delay for any reason, it has to be brought expediently to the Board of Selectmen's table so that we can resolve it. The he said, she said that this is now another week delayed, so we missed this summer, is not acceptable to me. You know, there may be reasons, legitimate ones, but it shouldn't be because of communications issue. If we have somebody that's holding up the works at this point in time, we need to get them at a table,
have them talk it through the issues and make it go away, because this is not, you know, spending this kind of money, it's not going to drag out another year, because I don't think it's going to hold water.
I think we're all concerned that the damage, there'll be more extensive damage if there's a delay. So we want to make sure it happens. You know, we need to bite the bullet and move forward. And, you know, so we want to make sure that everyone is speaking to each other and that we do resolve it. And Marty, we have had that conversation. So just pick up the phone and we'll make a meeting. We'll have an emergency meeting and make sure it happens, because, you know, I very much appreciate you and Patty putting so much effort to make sure that, you know, at least half of this roof is being paid for by the state. So
I think we're on track now.
Yeah.
And my hope is that we'll continue to do so.
So just because both Pink and Company and RDA are here, so you feel that we can go out to bid and get this done this summer?
Yes.
Okay. So all
as long as 3-1 is positive.
As long as it's passed.
Right.
Yes.
I mean, we're assuming
if 3-1 fails, I think it goes into a different.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, we have to figure out something different. But if the vote is positive on Monday, I mean on Tuesday, March 1st, then we can go out to bid and have the roof constructed through the summer.
And it will be. I think the 11-week window will be sufficient.
Okay.
I mean, weather dependent,
right? Well, obviously, but
right.
In general, we should be all on the same page. Is that correct?
RDA, that is correct.
And Pink and Company.
Yes.
Okay. We want to see the roof getting done.
And I mean, right now we're teed up that after 3-1, when your vote is yes, we have reached out or are reaching out to get on Dick's schedule so we could have that next set of review comments and go back and forth so they could finish.
Okay.
So that's, you know, kicking off that process.
All right.
I'm fairly confident that Dick Halaszewski has people on board to assist him with the review of the 100% docs in order to expedite that.
No, I think he left.
Okay. Smart man.
No, I believe he said that.
Yeah.
But
he definitely wants to make sure that he can turn those around as quickly as possible.
Right. So, okay. I just wanted to make clear from the Board of Selectmen that it's really important that this gets done this summer and that we don't put it off for another year, you know, just because of the potential for additional damage to the building.
We're going to make those dates.
Okay.
Total number of squares on the building?
Well, there's 80,000 square feet if you divide it by 100.
Yeah. Yeah. And you said there's 4,000 square feet of...
of membrane roof.
Membrane roof.
And yes.
That adds to how many squares?
40.
No, total.
84?
84.
800. 804. Yeah. 800 squares on the pitched roof and 40 on the flat roof.
Hope you're right. Because we'll save a lot of money. Because a lot of the forms we're looking at is talking about a 1,000 squares.
No, we did a true calculation. We took the existing drawings. We didn't do the square footage of the footprint. We understand the overhangs. We did it.
Okay.
We did a complete calculation of it.
That's music to my ear, because basically that's less square footage that has to be done. So.
Well, thank you very much for coming tonight.
And the date of the debt exclusion vote is?
March 1st.
This coming Tuesday.
This coming Tuesday. Super Tuesday, Super Tuesday, primary day.
Yep.
Come out and vote for the debt exclusion.
What are the hours?
7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
7 a.m. to 8 p.m.
Yep.
Just to clarify, 7 a.m. to 8 p.m. You have all day to come.
I have a couple other things. Doug, sure. Did we want to talk about anything about the permits?
Yes. The building inspector spoke to me a little bit earlier today, and it's based on a conversation I think he had with Jeff in regard to... asking the board to waive the permit fees related to this project. That would be building permit fees as well as electrical and plumbing as needed. It makes perfect sense, because otherwise the town has to pay the town a permit fee. The building inspector's request was further, though, that if the only fees that should not be waived would be fees required for a second inspection of the same work. If somebody puts something down, thinks it's done, asks for it to be inspected, and the inspector comes along and says, no, that's really completely off, the building inspector normally, in any kind of situation, has the opportunity to charge a re-inspection fee. And Dick said that in many cases, he mandates that that re-inspection fee be borne entirely by the contractor and that it not be passed over to the owner of the structure. He asked that that provision be written into the contract in this case as well. If the contractor...
I just want everyone to realize, I put the question out there, every town's different, whether they want to waive the fee or not. The one thing you have to understand is if you did charge the fee, it's a non-reimbursable.
That was going to be my question.
Yeah.
If I can get the stage paid for 50% of it, I wasn't going to...
sees that you're paying yourself.
Right. So
and,
I don't have an issue with it.
So that's the concern. Yeah.
Would you like us to take a formal vote on that?
Just as long as you guys agree, however you want to do it, I just...
Well, I think that we have consensus of what Doug expressed is the fact that we'll waive all original fees or the first fees that are, but any re-inspection fees because of fault of something.
There's two items there.
Sure.
The original permit fee and then inspection fees. Those are two separate.
But right. I think
I'm asking for consideration on both.
Right.
And what we're at, then what the building inspector has mentioned is if there's a re-inspection that is borne by the contractor at no cost to the owner.
I think what we're saying is we're going to waive the original building permit fee.
Okay.
And the original,
inspection fee.
Good.
All right. And if there is any reason to do re-inspections, it's on the cost of the it's on the contractor.
Correct.
Or whoever made the mistake.
And we can make that a formal vote if you choose, but
that's fine. If you want to do that a formal vote, that's fine.
So to waive all building and permit fees for the project.
Original.
I make a motion that
inspection fees.
That we waive
the
building permit fees and inspect the original inspection fees. Any re-inspection fees to re-inspect questionable or faulty work would be on the contractor.
Second that, if that's what you're looking for.
Faulty work would be borne by the contractor.
We can get Dick to finesse the word so that they're legal, if you would like.
I have the language sent to Doug already.
Oh,
or
okay.
To Patty, excuse me. I believe I sent
all
it
right.
to Patty.
Well, we'll make the vote. If there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
I'd like to not have the vote because if he's got the words, why put it into our records as something that's permanent?
Right. Well, I meant
I just think the intent is there, and with that in case.
We can vote it on Friday. We'll get the wording. We have a meeting on Friday.
Yes.
And we'll get the exact wording so there's no question.
I will update my language to include the re-inspection fees language. And
then we will formally vote it on Friday. At our selectmen's meeting on Friday.
All right.
We'll forward all of that to Doug. So, Doug,
yes.
You'll have that.
I do have that.
That way it's not confusing and there's no question what we our intent. But I think you have the gist of our conversation.
Yes. I think we all have. That's pretty good.
Was there anything else that you might have had a question on? Or?
One was administrative, but I talked to Doug. It was the weekly payroll reports. Where did they go? And he had told me that to send those to Patty Cavanaugh.
I'll put a caveat on that I haven't talked to Patty about that.
Okay.
And I'll defer to her role as the procurement officer on that.
Okay.
If it's more appropriate for the Board of Selectmen to keep those records here, then I'm happy to take that on. But I figure if Patty is already the procurement officer on the project, if she's okay with keeping those files, that's fine with me.
So you understand is that there is a checks and balances. I talked to Alicia from Pink, and they actually review it, make sure that coincides with the workforce that is on site, and then they provide a review response or something like that to whoever that is in the town.
Yep. Ultimately, I think the town has to keep the records as part of the record of the overall project. That's part of public record.
Right, but Patty is acting as procurement officer, right. But I think that can be worked out. You and Patty can.
Is that a signed review of the documentation?
I put it in the documents so that, you know, I make someone, you know, whether you, I can just say the town of Deerfield and leave it at that, but I do have you know, whether it's a business manager or whoever that is.
No, I meant from Pink & Company. They do that review before they forward it to us. Is that a signed review that they validated the manpower on site?
Yes.
Okay.
That's state requirements, right?
Yes, it's part of the MSPA process.
Okay. I haven't read that. All right. Limited time. Okay. A little bit anyways.
And I'm I've sent the insurance information to Doug, and he's provided me responses, and we're going back and forth, and we're going to finalize it, and then I'm going to send the document for a final review of the insurance requirements.
For the most part, it's already gone through Susan Nadeel at MIIA, and for the most part, her response has been positive. That in a couple of cases, the insurance requirements in the proposed bid documents exceed what Maya would actually mandate, which is terrific. There's some small wordsmithing on a couple of details, which we're just trying to finalize.
Okay.
So we're just dotting the I's, crossing the T's.
Okay. Perfect.
Coming along.
Okay. Well, thank you very much.
Any other questions from the audience?
Okay.
Thank you, Kai.
Right. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And if anyone has any in the audience, if that out in TV land, if they have any questions, get them to Doug, and we can forward it to Pink & Company and RDA so that we can get an answer.
Thank you.
Prior to our vote.
Thank you.
Have a nice evening, everybody.
Say happy birthday to your husband.
Thank you, Marty. I appreciate it, and thank you for the pictures. I think they were very informative.
Easy enough. Happy to do it.
It's very helpful. Thank you. Actually, maybe we, Marty, we can leave them here, and we can, in case anyone wants to see them between now and Tuesday. Is that all right?
Sure.
Okay.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah, I think, why don't we leave them with Doug in case someone wants to come in?
I was going to say, you have them all, because I sent them to Doug. I find one and
okay.
Send them. And
they're already on his thumb drive, so.
Oh, okay, fine.
I'm
that's
sure
wonderful,
it's already
then.
In your computer.
Okay.
I appreciate it.
Okay,
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Marty.
Public comment? Selectman's comments, Mark.
Let's make sure that, is there any public comment? No public comment? Okay. Go ahead, I'm sorry. No, Selectman, they had a informative meeting at the Tilton Library for the needs assessment in the building committee. It was well attended. Unfortunately, it was in the basement of the very cramped Tilton Library, so people got very friendly with one another.
But it was cold, so it was okay.
Yes, it was. Unfortunately, I had to leave in the middle of it, and we came back to it later, but it was, and Carolyn came over, too, to watch it. So they're well on their way to formalizing the thought process for the Tilton Library's needs and building committee. So please don't hesitate to stop by and talk to them, find out what's going on, and put your two cents into the pot at this point, because now is the time before it gets so far along you can't say anything. The SCEMS had a meeting last 30, which is the ambulance service, last Thursday, I believe.
Yes.
And they've asked the building committee for the group to actually go look at what the negotiations process is going to look like for space, square footage, and build out for the space over in Waite Least Wormhouse building. There was a good report put out by the director. The director
has it on the website, and it should be accessible through our town meeting. We had a meeting scheduled for last night with the South County Senior Center. We're talking about the research officer, a resource outreach person. The outreach, we have a grant to have an outreach person come in. We're looking at space because they need privacy to do interviewing of people, and how that's going to work. The board, even though we did not have a quorum on site, we had, myself was on a phone link, and Tom Feinkevitz was the only one that was actually at the building. So we had a informative discussion, and basically the board, without making a decision, expressed the thought process that it was more important to get the outreach person in place sooner than later, and to impress upon the director that it's probably in everybody's best interest to start bringing things to the table. So I think that hopefully in the next couple of weeks we'll get some sort of output, what they're going to do it and how they're going to get it. We've got a grant that runs to the end of June. We want to use some of that money out for outreach. The position's been empty for a little while.
Mark, can you define outreach a little bit? What kind of...
What we do is...
I think that would be interesting.
The director's been doing most of the outreach of trying to find why seniors may not be coming to the facility, whether they have needs of staying in-house, whether or not they need rides on getting places, whether they need somebody to help them shop, whether they need what the needs are of the very growing population of seniors, which I have to count myself on right now. But it's basically to get out to the community and either reach into people who can't get there but would like services, or to bring services in. We bring in tax consultants, we bring in foot doctors, we have the nurse come over and deal with the all of that requires somebody to coordinate, to actually test the waters to determine if what's really necessary, so we don't waste money on doing something wrong. Outreach is getting classes in the elementary school or at the library or someplace because we don't have the facilities to put on a lot of classes. We get computers in the senior center to have people use it, because basically the increased number of seniors that are using computers is great. And that kind of outreach is something that, from the day-to-day operations of the facility, you've got one person with the support staff, and outreach gets left behind. So it's been something the state has trying to promote, and we're trying to take full advantage of it. So it's not something that's a full-blown cost to us, but it's it costs us energy and learning. Did that answer the question?
Okay. I outreach just has a lot of different components, and I thought people would be interested to know.
Yeah, and I mean, it would be, like if a good number of population or the seniors wanted to take a trip somewhere to a museum or do something, they'd reach out to the other organizations or group up with another facility to cut down on the cost of doing something like that. That would be the person who would take that information and look at it. To help people do living wills or whatever the I just say flavor of the day, but as you watch TV, you get a lot of people get planting seeds as to you need more insurance, you need to protect yourself, you need a home burglar system, you need this. A lot of them can be scams, and nobody has any good places to turn. So we're connecting the good places, the sheriff's department, the police department, the fire department, the insurance fraud department to this group and have them come in and do speaks with them. Triad has been a great population of actually going door to door with to talk to seniors.
That's wonderful. Yeah.
So we're trying to make sure that we support them so they stay in our region, and working with the transit people to come to the doors and actually have some way of people getting to a grocery store and actually picking up groceries rather than boiling that third bag of tea out of that one pot. So it's a wonderful function, and we'd like to see it get moving faster. And that covers my three areas that I'm focused on.
I just had a question, Mark. Could we, when do you expect the SCEMS budget?
They have it.
Okay.
Should it was approved in concept at that meeting also, and it is, Doug has it for.
I do have a copy of it. It's in draft format. I'll make sure that it's available to you on Friday. I'm going to try to present a full, complete budget to the board on Friday. There are a couple of numbers that I'm still trying to work through with the town clerk, as well as the town accountant, to make sure that the offsets for things like retirement costs and health insurance costs are as accurate as they can be. And assuming those numbers are good, the budget will be part and parcel.
I was wondering if we should set up an informational session with the selectmen and the finance committee on that, so that all the questions could be answered.
I know that the finance committee is at least the chair of the finance committee has expressed interest in having another joint session with the board of selectmen.
Okay.
To talk about not only specific budget items but generally about the process, where we're at, where we're going. So
okay.
I think that the director is scheduled to be at the finance committee to present his
okay.
budget to
let's,
them already.
Let's coordinate so it's not like they have to come back multiple times. Let's
sure.
coordinate.
Well, I think the budget is pretty straightforward, and it's living within the limited knowledge that we have of doing budgets. In other words, and it's a there's no increase in the line items. They move the monies around so that it's
okay.
They can see it, and it's discussion. So basically, anybody has any concerns, do not hesitate. Don't wait till
go
to a meeting. Send it to Zach,
that,
and Zach will get it to the board.
We had that informational meeting, and it was really nice to have everybody asking the same questions at the same time.
That was for all the budgets. Yeah,
and have everyone there to answer the questions and talk about it. So. It seemed like it worked pretty well last year,
mm-hmm.
so I thought maybe we could do that again. So, but if it's not necessary.
Well, I think that the Finance Committee will be the one that's reviewing the budget. I think that Doug's done a phenomenal job of putting
okay.
together the budget, and if we have questions, and anybody that reviews it has questions, whether it's capital improvement, whether it's finance or whatever. If Doug starts getting the questions, he should be able to go, okay, we need to have a group meeting because basically we didn't get the message across. It's not transparent enough to work the numbers.
I just wanted to make sure it was productive.
Oh, absolutely. And I think that I'd rather call more meetings than less, but let's make sure that we got reasons to call them.
Okay.
So,
Board of Health comments. I just, based on the number of phone calls, I have six more phone calls to return. I literally have not been home. I will return those phone calls. Most of the phone calls are related to the Zika virus. I have to say that not a lot is known at this time. People are learning more every day. The Department of Public Health is pretty much doing what the CDC, whatever CDC passes out, that's what Department of Public Health is saying. And, we had our Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition meeting on Monday. It was a major part of our discussion. And like the H1N1, we felt we were not getting satisfied or satisfied in our answers that we were getting in our attempts to have conversations. We've been on conference calls. We've talked to the Department of Ag, Department of Public Health, a lot of different questions back and forth. So we're having a focus group meetings where we're just doing putting together informational sheets, just like we did for the H1N1. And just like in the H1N1, I'm assuming the state will end up using our information sheets as across the state, because we're putting a lot of effort into it. We've had a couple different conversations, and so we'll have this fact sheet out probably in the next week or two. We're working up recommendations. The mosquito that passes the Zika virus now that they're talking about, it doesn't go beyond Long Island at this point. It's not expected in the state until 2020, around that time frame. While 2020 is only 4 years away, people are like, well, it could be here. And the Asian tiger mosquito is what we have that's in Connecticut. It's in places like Worcester. That can pass the Zika virus potentially. And that's an aggressive mosquito that bites all day long. We have some of them, but they don't generally make it over the winter here. So it's not a huge risk, but it's potentially an issue. Dick and I have been working with several different communities up and down the Pioneer Valley for the last 3 years. We were trying to do a mosquito control district, and that just does not seem to be panning out with the state. We're just having a hard time, and we're just not going to Boston anymore. So what we've done is we've vetted several different, this is a whole group of us, we've vetted several different contractors. We've come up with Vector Disease Control International. They're out of Sutton, Mass. Very nice person, reputable company. We've gotten a couple proposals. We're, you know, putting it in the budget. We are doing more, and we intend to do more, and we tend to be on top of this as issues. It's brand new. Like I said, we're going to, you know, there's several major studies out for repellent. We're going to have recommendations for that kind of stuff. But basically, it's just like the flu stuff. You wash your hands. That's the most productive thing you can do to fight colds and flu and germs. Mosquitoes can breed in the cap of Mark's water bottle. The difference between, supposedly, between South America and Central America and us is we have mosquito control districts, which we don't have up here, and we don't have trash but and junk in our backyards. But if you walk around after a rainstorm, there's water in pots, flower pots, there's all kinds of stuff in your yards. So the basic recommendation from us is you have to patrol your yard. You have to take responsibility for your areas that you are in. Mosquitoes travel about, you know, up to a half a mile at the most. So what we're going to do is do an assessment. Hopefully, if the money is passed in the budget, we'll do an assessment of where we have to watch mosquito pools. We will continue with our Board of Health and DPW putting in discs, mosquito larvicide discs, in catch basins in a few areas, and we'll do some trapping of the identified potential areas for some of these mosquito issues, and then we'll have a potential spraying program of options, and we will look at the options so people feel very comfortable at what the spraying is. We'll have a presentation here. If money stays in the budget, we'll have them come out and do a presentation. The difference in cost for us, if all the communities up and down the valley work together, is tremendously reduced. So if we have a person out here that's shared by multiple communities, it will be a much lesser cost. And so we're talking about $11,000 as a baseline. And the approach here is, this is like a snow and ice budget. This is a result of climate change or evolution, whatever you want to say. The fact is, we have more bugs. We have potential issues with West Nile, Triple E, and now Zika. So this will be like a snow and ice budget. We're going to have an established amount baseline. In a very wet year, we're going to might have to do some spraying. In a dry year, there won't be as much trapping, and we won't have to do spraying. So it's going to be an up and down scenario, and we're going to try to share the costs as much as we can with other communities. And eventually, as it gets, if the situation gets worse, we will keep pursuing trying to get spraying equipment through a grant, and we will train our own people to spray. But we'll have more knowledge over time as to what we will do and understand what the mosquito issue is mostly in town. So we are, and it's complicated because now they're talking about Zika being as passed through sexual transmission. So if someone's been to Central or South America and has been in infected, and then they come back here, potentially there could be a risk for up to 60 days to some, you know, if you have sex. So when we get more information, when we have quick tests developed and vaccines and we have more control over mosquitoes, we'll have more information. But hopefully by next week, we'll have had some information to for handouts. Stuff, as soon as we get it, will be on our website. We're having a complete presentation in March at our Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition meeting on what to do and as communities what we can do and how we can act cooperatively. So more information is forthcoming. So you don't need to call me because I don't really have a lot more than that. You know, we're trying to stay on top of it. Okay. Mark, did you have any comments or anything?
Yep. This might stop some more callings to you, or it may create more calls to me. I'm in favor of the first phase of this, where we figure out what we have for risks and what we should do about them in a what we call engineering design change, where Carolyn said empty the pots of water in your yard. Well, resurface areas so that basically the standing water is not there where you don't want standing water to be. Doing that engineering protective things, I'm fully in favor of. When we get to the third phase, when we start talking about spraying, I have more negative experiences that came up 20 years later that fell out from the right thing or thinking of the right thing to do. So I'm going to be very leery about proposals without actually understanding the chemistry of it and how it's going to actually not affect the environment. But I think that the important thing is when we get to that second phase and we've identified what's going to happen, we can advise people that they need to take protective actions, whether it's use sunscreen or stay inside or do whatever it is, especially so many hours after a rainstorm or something like this, where we can help you change your habits so that basically you're limiting your liability of getting bit. I'm all in favor. When we transition over that third one, I'm a little leery of the design. So don't jump off the or
I was just
going to
say, please don't call me about spraying because that is like down the line, totally down the line.
That's the part I wanted to make sure is you understand that basically there's a lot of steps.
No one is agreeing to spraying, and we don't even know. But the assessment part is really important so we can find out where our areas are, and then you do some trapping to find out what the bugs are, you know, what diseases are, you know, here, and then you decide what to do for spraying. But the spraying thing is hugely down the line. I have no information on that other than there has been some success out on the Cape with sterilization of males. We would certainly not do anything to hurt honeybees. I would guarantee that. So please don't call me to save the honeybees because I'm totally for that. I don't want people. I don't have any information on the spraying part. This is we haven't gotten that far yet. We're just talking about basic prevention.
Another attack on the males. I like this.
know.
It's politically correct. Let's go after the males. Okay.
Well, the females are the ones that only, all the females are the ones that bite, so.
Jesus, let's think. We're going to kill the ones that don't bite. Okay. No. And this is legitimate. I like this idea.
Well, I'm trying to make it balanced, so you know that.
Oh, boy.
Anyway, did you have anyone have any questions about it? Jeff, you raised your hand, did you? Okay. I really don't have any more information about the spraying thing, so please don't call me about that because I don't know yet. But hopefully within the next month, we'll get this sorted out, and we'll have a presentation by the person. He's very nice. He's very patient, and he's incredibly knowledgeable. So we'll have him come and do a full presentation so we know everyone feels comfortable who the company we're working with. We really did do an extensive research on who we'd want to work with. And Northampton has already signed on with them. Hopefully Amherst will go through the budget process and that line item will stay in with them. West Springfield is looking into this very, I believe they have an item on their budget for it. So that's what we're doing. Greenfield is doing this with us. To give you an idea, if we did this by ourselves, it's about $39,000. If we do this jointly with other communities, it's $11,000. So it becomes very reasonable the more communities participate. So that's why we're having the informational meetings through the Mohawk Area Public Health Coalition, because we're trying to get the information out and have more communities sign on, because that also reduces the price. Like I said, basically we're having everybody, we're sharing a person up and down the Pioneer Valley. That's what we want to do. And obviously it works out cheaper when there's more communities on board. So that's all I have on that. If there's no other comments, then, keep washing your hands. The flu season is from full swing. Minutes of February 5th?
I regret those are not ready.
Okay, I was going to say
tonight.
I didn't see
I hope
them.
To have
okay.
the 5th and the 10th, and I think at the meeting on the 10th we reviewed a lot of minutes from January.
Yes.
So I hope to have the minutes for the 5th and the 10th ready to go, possibly even Friday.
That's fine.
Yep.
Next item on the agenda is approval of the one-day liquor license for the Amherst Chamber of Commerce event at Yankee Candle.
Yep.
Mark, do you have any issues with that?
So moved.
Second. All those in favor?
Any comments? Aye.
Aye. Okay. Signing of the contract with the Fitzgerald Fence Company for the Sugarloaf Cemetery fence.
This is something I just need your signature on. This is in the actual formal contract related to the award of the construction. It's actually asking for the signature of the chair of the Board of Selectmen, but I think a chair pro temp will work just fine.
Okay. Mark, do you want to make a motion?
This is the first time.
This is the contract for the construction of the fence at Sugarloaf Cemetery. We went out with an invitation for bid near the end of this past year in November, and the board awarded the contract to Fitzgerald Fences, having the lowest bid in accordance with the terms of the invitation for bid.
Do you think they'll be done by Memorial Day?
Absolutely. They have. They've already been speaking with the Historical Commission. John Novay has visited their site. Jane Trigere has visited their shop as well. John has reviewed the materials that they're going to be using for posts, as well as the materials they're going to be using for rails, and he's given at least tentative approval on both. They're right in line with what they're hoping the fence will look like. And as soon as we get this contract signed, Fitzgerald will place the order for the materials. Those materials are expected to be in 6 to 8 weeks, so they should be able to start construction in mid-April. They expect it to take a very short amount of time. They are aware that they need to notify us at least 2, if not 3 weeks out before they expect to start construction, because the highway department is going to be responsible for taking the old fence down, and that's going to be a couple of days of work.
Kevin's fine, and Kevin's
okay. fully aware of that.
Okay, yeah. Perfect.
Yeah. So there's no real vote that needs to be taken. It's just a contract that needs to be authorized. That's it.
All right. I think, well, town meeting approved it, so. All right. Today, today's the 24th. Okay. Next item on the agenda is payroll and vendor warrants. I think we've done that. Discussion items, New England Patient Network host agreement.
In the packet of information, you do have an updated and revised host agreement. It's actually printed on 11 by 17, so you can read the contract itself as well as the comments that were provided. I don't expect that you're going to take any action on this tonight, but I wanted to make sure that you're aware that this is still something that's ongoing. We have received some information back from Nick Spagnola in terms of revisions to the contract. Highlighted are the terms of the host agreement in terms of the payment. The expectation is upon a receipt of a license to operate from the Department of Public Health, that New England Patient Network will make a payment to the town in the amount of $50,000 on the first day that they receive final approval. From thereafter, New England Patient Network agrees to make payments, annual payments to the town of Deerfield, in the amount equal to 2% of their gross annual revenues derived from sales out of this retail location. The first recurring payment shall be due 1 year after final approval is received from the Department of Public Health. This is a significant change from what we'd seen before. We'd seen hard round dollar amounts previous to this. And now it was a percentage of retail sales. So the question I sent out to Nick was, okay, what do you expect your retail sales to look like? We have received a response. The low end estimates are somewhere between 2.2 and 2.3 million in the first full year of operation. 2% of that roughly translates to $42,000 or $43,000 a year.
That's the low end.
That is the low end. That's the low expectation. However, my work with Brenda Hill says work with the lowest expectation and be pleasantly surprised when you exceed them.
Absolutely.
A couple of outstanding questions remain. And with your permission, I'd like the okay to negotiate some of the terms of this agreement in connection with Chief John Pachorek. We've set up a tentative meeting for this coming Tuesday, where both the chief as well as myself will be meeting with Nick to go over the terms of this agreement. The chief is pretty suggested that the town could and should negotiate for an accelerator to this percentage, 2% in year two, maybe 2.5% in 2% in year one, maybe 2.5% in year two, maybe 3.5% in year three, or whatever the terms might be. The rest of the agreement has been vetted by legal counsel and does seem pretty solid, but we just want to try to negotiate the best possible terms for the town.
Absolutely.
So I may have more news on Friday, but it's likely that it's going to take a couple weeks.
Okay.
So.
All right. Approval of MOU for the pellet bags.
I think you have a copy of this MOU in your packet. This is almost ridiculous to have to sign it because it's a memorandum of agreement with the Franklin County Solid Waste District for an additional payment of $350 per year for the pickup of pellet bags. Unfortunately, this used to be something that we were able to do for free because of the benefits of recycling, but with the low cost of petroleum, the benefit of recycling the financial benefit has dropped through the floor. And so now we're actually paying to get rid of recyclables. It's just not worth the money for people to recycle, which is sad, really, actually. But this is a MOU to allow us to continue to get the pellet bags taken away. It would cost us $350 a year.
I make a motion that we sign this. I think it has been successful, from what I understand.
Yes.
Okay.
Where are they going to?
I actually am not really sure. Let me take a quick look at the...
It's all right.
Let's read it and see if...
No, it doesn't say, but...
It does not say. Yep.
I'm assuming it's the same... well, what happened is the innovative...
Yes.
Community innovative grant was... Challenge grant was used up.
Yep.
So I think it's going to the same place, but now we just have to pick up the cost.
The removal of the materials, the pellet bags, and where they go for recycling is in the hands of the Solid Waste District. Basically, the agreement is to just help offset the hauling costs, a small portion of the hauling costs, and to basically oblige the town to maintain the shed. Right there. I think there's two copies of that.
He has no comment, no... Kevin has no issues with that?
Not at all. Not at all.
Maintaining the shed.
Did you second it, Mark?
I will, since I don't remember whether I did or didn't, so I'll second it. And I shouldn't have started a conversation until I seconded it, so beg for forgiveness on the fact that I didn't follow protocol.
Nope. do you have further discussion on it?
No. Okay, it's everybody sign it. I have no further comments.
Okay, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Next item on the agenda is appointment of the Board of Selectmen Office Administrative
Clerk. I am so pleased to do this for a number of reasons. Over the past 2.5 weeks, the town has been receiving applications for a part-time, temporary administrative clerk to assist us in the town administrator's office. We had interviews with a total of four candidates. A fifth candidate unfortunately opted out because they realized that it was only a part-time position. We had great interviews with all four candidates. It was a very difficult decision. It came down to two, and it was a heartbreaking decision for me for a variety of reasons. But the final candidate that I'd like to present to you on request your appointment is a young woman named Kathleen Dolan. Kathleen most recently was a 9/11 dispatcher for the town of Northampton. She came very highly recommended, not only by her supervisor, but also by the folks who manage the dispatch center down there. She came across to all the members of the committee as very organized, very clear-spoken, intelligent, and very eager to assist. She brings a can-do attitude to the job. She also brings a bachelor's degree in political science and an MBA from UMass of Amherst. We've talked to her about the potential for this job to continue perhaps after the 1st of July, but also that this may end as of July 1. And in either case, she's very willing to get started and is very eager for the opportunity and the experience. So with your consent, I would request that you appoint Kathleen Dolan as administrative clerk, temporary, for a term to commence immediately and to end June 30th, 2016.
I make a motion that we hire Kathleen Dolan immediately, and I'm glad you're so thrilled and happy that you'll have assistance in the office, Doug.
You had no idea.
I know. No, I do have an idea.
Question?
Yes. Oh, wait, let Mark second it.
Second. Go ahead.
Go ahead.
How many hours is she going to be?
18 per week.
So no benefits involved.
Correct. And remember, we're running understaff,
right,
as it is.
Yeah, no, I understand. Just
yep.
To clarify.
No, we clarified it was going to be temporary until we decide what we're going to do.
Okay. Thank you.
I think we should, let's finish.
No, go ahead, Mark.
No, nope, it's outside of the realm of the vote, so.
Oh, okay. if there's no further discussion, all those in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Make that unanimous, Doug, please.
Thank you.
Hopefully she can start yesterday.
she'll be here tomorrow morning.
Oh, great. Absolutely. Great. I'm actually really happy for you, Doug. You know, my really concern was that you were going to get burned out.
Not yet.
Okay.
That's good.
2 points. First one is consent agenda and discussion.
I apologize for that. I should have introduced that before you got to it. A consent agenda, you're aware of what it is.
I'm getting the impression.
Wait, where are you, Mark?
Under our agenda. He's got it broken out by consent agenda part 6 and part 7.
Correct.
Oh.
Okay, so we...
You chose to vote on things independently, which is just fine.
Oh, I see what you're talking about. I'm sorry. I was like...
It's a new concept to the agenda for the Board of Selectmen.
Okay, but...
I'm sorry, go ahead.
I'm lost, so I want to make sure I've got this clear because...
Okay.
Which one should we be voting for? Because we voted for both of them.
You approved the one-day liquor license.
Yep.
For the Amherst Chamber of Commerce.
Yep.
You signed the contract with Fitzgerald Fence.
Yep.
And you approved signing of the payroll and vendor warrants, I believe.
Right.
Yeah, we already did that.
Yeah.
The idea behind a consent agenda is that and again, this is a brand new concept, and I apologize for throwing it at you without pre-warning. I wish I had time to go back
Not
and
a problem.
Do it again.
It's,
but as we move forward, there may be a very large number of very small, very basic, and very expected items that you can dispose of with a single vote. By going through the consent agenda, you know, we can include minutes on there. We can include the signing of the payroll and vendor warrants at the convenience of the board on that. And so you can simply say, I move the consent agenda as presented, second, in favor, aye, boom.
Oh, I see what you're saying.
And you're done with 7 or 8 or 10 pieces of business in one swell swoop. It's a mechanism that we can talk more about. You can choose to not have it there, or it's up to you.
Oh, I think it's great. I just think that appointing a part-time temporary person should probably be in the consent agenda instead of us having to vote for it. And some of the MOUs probably should be in the discussion and decision. I'm just going to feel my way through that thought process of where they belong. It just, usually I'm used to having these are what we vote for, and these are the ones we don't vote for.
Okay.
And I'm not asking you to change, and please don't.
That's all right. One thing that over the past 6 weeks has been very tough for me to do is to get an agenda well ahead of time for the board to consider, as well as all the materials. I'm hoping that will change over the next couple of weeks as we move forward with an extra set of hands there.
We're fine.
But I definitely am hearing your concerns.
So now we're into the budget discussion. Doug, you have repairs to Town Hall and repairs to South County. Do you want to go into that?
Sure. There is in the town's coffers a fund called the Municipal Building Fund. Let me take the ancient history for those of you who are watching and may not know about this. The Municipal Building Fund was created, as far as we can tell, with the sale of the original old Deerfield Elementary School to to PVMA back in either the late 90s or early 2000s. That was a certain sum of money, about $600,000, a portion of which went into this fund. The fund was further enhanced with the sale of the old Town Hall over here on Park Street, but since then has been used as a funding source for the budget. Basically, a slice of the money from that fund has been taken out at annual town meeting as a funding source for the budget. That was started sometime in the mid-2000s, late 2000s, and continued up to even last year. Right now, that fund has about $90,000 in it. My request is to, and I'd like to get the board's direction on this, my suggestion is to take the remainder of that fund, or much of the remainder of that fund, and use it as a funding source for certain capital projects that need to happen, certain projects, small items, at Town Hall and at the South County Senior Center building. You should have some information in your packet, and I apologize, it's a little scattershot, but it relates to the rekeying of Town Hall and the replacement of a couple of doors. Two separate vendor estimates, I think, are in there. I'm working with Kevin to get an estimate for a lot of the cleanup over at the Senior Center, including the cleanup of the basement, the removal and abatement of mold, the removal of materials that can continue to cause or hold mold from the basement, as well as the removal of certain materials from the second floor to basically clean the second floor up. His concern is not about asbestos, but mostly about heavy metal-based paint, lead-based paint. He got an estimate on that, which was surprisingly low, and he is working on getting a revised estimate for that. In all, we're looking at maybe $40,000, $45,000 worth of projects, and there's almost double that amount in the municipal building fund right now. So what I would like to do is actually have a separate article on town meeting floor, or to have some capital items on town meeting floor funded from the municipal building fund specifically to get these things done. One other project I'm sorry I didn't mention is the fact that the fire alarm system in town hall, if there's a fire, assuming the system works, the only thing that happens is a red light flashes kind of out in the front. Alarms will go off in the building, but unless somebody is nearby or sees the light or hears the alarms, nobody is called. The fire department isn't called. The police department isn't called. Kevin has looked at an upgrade to that system, which would actually create 24/7 monitoring for both the police department side and the town hall side. They would monitor CO2. They would monitor smoke. And would actually reach out to a call list in case an alarm went off, particularly in the off hours. The upgrade of that equipment is only about $2,000, and the annual fee for the monitoring is about $360 a year. It's very, very cheap insurance, and may actually improve our insurance rating with Maya. It may save money in the long run. Again, just another example of one of those projects that we'd like to do and would like to use that funding for.
I know Kevin is relatively new to this, but he, you know, just make sure he is coordinating with Maya so that whatever improvements that we do, or that Maya can give us a list of stuff that we can do that will reduce our expenses and costs.
Kevin should be meeting with Maya. That should be through our office.
Yeah.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, no, yeah. No, I don't.
Just needs to tell us if you fix something so we can make sure we take advantage of whatever benefits he did.
Right. And there's
I agree. And I'm happy to work with Kevin to make sure that the upgrades do meet specs and will help us out in the insurance.
Yeah, I mean, there's stuff like driver safety programs. And,
oh, yeah.
I mean, Kevin is mostly aware of this, but just coordinate everything. I mean, one of the reasons we switched to Maya was because we could take advantage of some of these discounts with the educational programs that they have, and things that we're going to do anyway. We might as well get credit on our insurance for. So, just make sure that there's good communication there on what we can take advantage of.
To that end, actually, I've been in contact with. I'm trying to remember his name. It's the gentleman at Maya who actually coordinates these types of programs. And he's hopefully going to be coming in next week to meet with myself, possibly with Kevin, and possibly with the chief, to talk about opportunities for training of town staff. And you're absolutely right. For the training, if the town staff participates in the training, whether it's proper lifting technique or first responder, anti-choking, basic CPR, Maya even has a driving simulator that they'd be willing to bring here and to try to take
put
our EMT that. Drivers, our police officers, our DPW drivers through it. And those all earn points, which can actually reduce the cost of insurance. And they're all free. Maya wants to do this for us. So we're definitely pursuing that.
Yeah. I mean, that's, like I said, that was one of the reasons we switched to Maya, because it looked, not only were they more competitive, but with the discounts, it was significantly, potentially more money.
Yep.
So that would be wonderful.
Yep. So in regard to the specific improvements to the two buildings, what I'd like to do is just get a more consolidated list and a better presentation for you. I've given you just some of the raw evidence, but I want to make sure that I'm going in the right direction.
Absolutely.
As long as the board is good with that, I will continue to pursue it.
Well, I'm good with it, but basically that money would be gone next year.
It's very likely.
So it's not a funding stream that's going to get us to think about keeping our buildings the way they need to be kept up. So it's a two-prong.
Sure.
And if we're going to keep this And I mean, I've been begging for money to go on the budget for cleaning up the senior center. So I think the reality is that no matter what we do, we need to get a wholesome look at how we do it, because basically this just gives us a two-year Band-Aid, I think at best, with some of the stuff we're running into.
The Capital Improvement Committee, if I could interrupt, Mark, is meeting after town meeting to start. We're going to do a five-year plan and suggest numbers to put away for maintenance as well as, you know, regular replacement of stuff, because we don't have a good plan in place.
The maintenance should be O&M, maintenance and operations of the facility, and we're not doing that.
Sure.
If we go to capital, we're not dealing with the capital things that we really need to talk about. In most towns, they have...
I know, it's the little stuff.
As much stuff as we've got in, you know, the process of saying, okay, we're not going to spend down free cash to this amount. There's a lot of towns that say, and that amount should also be into a capital stabilization fund so that when a roof goes or whatever, we're not at the mercy of the state building gurus who think that Deerfield's the same as Boston. And, you know, we got our feet on the fire, and we're going to pay. I mean, there's no choice in this aspect of it, unless the townspeople say, no, enough is enough. We're going to pay, and basically we're going to do it over and over again, because we're not putting away the amount of money that we need to fix the stuff that when it breaks. So I don't want to mix capital with...
I know. We had talked about putting it in.
Those big things, so I need to get Doug
Kevin has been directed to do more maintenance. I mean, put a line item in the budget for real maintenance, because real maintenance hasn't been done.
I'm gonna chime in here, and definitely in support of what Mark has been talking about and has been talking about for some time. You're absolutely right. Kevin did put in additional money into our municipal building budget for maintenance. We've got a foreman on duty now who's coming up to speed very quickly with all of the systems in our municipal buildings. And I know that Kevin is very interested in working on creating and sustaining a operational maintenance plan separate from a capital improvement plan. You're absolutely right. It's the day-to-day and week-to-week things that we just do, that we check on, that we enables us to keep our buildings longer in better shape versus, yeah, okay, the roof is gone, we've got to replace the roof, which you can plan for that, but it's not the same as making sure the filters have changed on the air handling system, for example.
I know. Okay. So you feel okay about those two issues then? Doug, you got enough answers from us?
I think so, yes.
Okay.
There are a number of other things that I guess are policy-driven related to the budget. The next thing on your agenda is PEG access funds. I've had a lot of conversations with Brenda Hill, and I've had several conversations with folks at the DOR. There is a legal mechanism coming in place, and I think we've talked about it, 53F3/4, which would mandate that we create a special fund for PEG access monies. The PEG access monies would go into that fund, would be protected and used for PEG access purposes only, would have to be paid out by order of town hall, the order of town meeting, like any other appropriation, instead of simply by approval of the PEG access budget by the Board of Selectmen, as it has been done in the past.
When did this take effect?
It already is in effect. The DOR has given a grace period before they start to reinforce it, before they start to come down on towns and cities for not making use of one of these mechanisms. July 1st is when they're going to start making this happen. Our town accountant has basically said, we need to do something before July 1st. Otherwise, the funds are simply going to roll into the general fund. That being said, the monies from PEG Access that we get from the franchise agreement still need to be used by for PEG Access purposes, without a doubt. That's mandated by the federal government, by FCC regulations. However, the recommendation I'm going to make may sound kind of odd. My recommendation is to not use any of the special funds, to let the PEG Access monies go into the general revenues. We would track them as a anticipated receipt for any given year. They would be paid out by an appropriation at town meeting. And I've worked with Brenda. We think the best place for that to happen is in the contracted services budget. And they would be still appropriated by town meeting once a year. But by doing that, the Board of Selectmen can choose to pay them out on a quarterly basis, or they can choose to not pay them out, depending on what they'd like to do. And the Board of Selectmen still keep the ability to review the budget for the PEG Access company, to review their performance, and so on and so forth. And so you keep control of the PEG Access function still at the Board of Selectmen level, for a number of reasons. It also allows the town more freedom. We don't have to appropriate the entire amount, and the entire amount of the appropriation doesn't need to be in our coffers at the time of appropriation like it would with one of those special funds. In other words, as we get money from Comcast, we can pay it out to the Access Center without any trouble. It gives the town a little bit more freedom to do that.
Do you have any questions on that, Mark? Because you're the one that's mostly involved in that.
I think that seems to be a lot of paperwork, swapping around thought processes. It's doing the same exact thing. What Doug's recommending is the same exact thing that we're doing.
Right.
It's just making it go through appropriations the way it, because I think that a lot of people spent the money where they shouldn't have spent it. I'm not worried about the town of Deerfield because we held on to the money and it went.
I was going to say we're really careful.
We're very careful. I mean, absolutely. We could have spent it a lot more if we got the schools to come forward and do some communications type thought process, but nobody ever came to us. So basically, we were pretty clean. And what Doug's saying is just keeping the status quo, but just putting another label on it. Instead of a dog, we're going to call it a cat. And it makes it, if it makes the state happy, we'll call it a cat. That's okay.
And that's really what it comes down to is...
Basically, so it's not... I don't have an issue with it.
It's the state setting rules for money that already has rules from the federal government as to how it can be used. So it's kind of ridiculous.
Sooner or later, they're going to make it so complicated that people are going to say we're not going to bother with it anymore, and then they win because they don't have to hear about it anymore.
So that's going to be codified into the budget. You'll see the PEG Access revenues coming in as an anticipated revenue line item, and you'll see the basically the expenditure for PEG Access operations going out of the contracted services budget. The downside of this further is literally we have to do an invitation for bid or a request for proposals. We have to go out for a public procurement for PEG Access. We've never done that. We probably should have done that. What I'm going to suggest is that we put an article on town meeting floor to give the selectmen the authority to enter into a 10-year agreement with a PEG Access Corporation, or a 1-year agreement with the option to renew 9 times, if you will, some manner like that.
How long is the PEG Access, the Comcast thing, is that 10 or 20 years?
The franchise agreement is 10 years.
So we'll just merit that.
Yeah.
We'll just make it end at the same time.
I do like the idea of a 1-year contract with the option for renewals up to 10 years. Simply because it still gives the Board of Selectmen the authority to either say, yes, you guys are doing great, we're going to renew it, thank you very much, or what the heck happened, we're going out for bid again.
Yeah.
It gives the Board of Selectmen still the authority.
I would prefer that myself.
So
okay.
So I'll talk with the resources and see if we can get an article on town meeting, the warrant for that. I need an answer. Do you guys want to fund the, do you want to include the police school resource officer in the budget?
Let me address that, please.
Oh, sure.
Okay.
basically, I think that there's a very strong desire to have the school resource officer in place. And I think that the funding mechanism is the issue that has to be resolved at this point. Mm-hmm. My gut feeling is that I feel that all parties that are going to take advantage of the service should pay for the service. And that means that the private schools have, to some degree, ponied up money to make that happen. The town's ponying up money because we're letting it happen, and it's coming out of our budgets in a way right now, and we will continue to support it to some degree. But I think we need to get our school partners to kick into the kitty at some point in time. And I'd like to put this on hold, and we'll discuss it at a later date. When we've had a chance, we hit the schools blindly with this. We did not give them time to address it or even talk about it. So I'd like to give them enough time to respond to our request that they be a part and parcel to it. Okay. And pick it up at our next meeting.
Okay, I have extended the request out to the schools. The chief has also followed up with the superintendent. I'm trying to make sure my memory is good. I believe the superintendent replied stating that the budgets were still under development and
Correct.
Still under review,
yep.
and that there was opportunities to speak to the school committees about
right.
Including this in their budget. If you would like, I can reach out to the chairs of both the elementary school as well as Frontier Regional School Committees right. and ask for an audience, or if you would like to do that, that would be
no,
fine.
No, I think that it would be appropriate for you to reach out to them and tell them where we're at and what we're thinking. If they want to sit and have a meeting with you about it, that's even more if you have time to support that in your busy schedule.
I'll make that a priority.
I think that it would be to everybody's benefit to have a good conversation about it.
Okay. I know that the Finance Committee has done a preliminary review of the chief's budget as he's presented, have indicated strong support for the school resource officer, so much so that they have said they would approve the budget with the inclusion of that money there, regardless of the source of the funding. They were very much in support of having that position included in the budget.
I have to stand to correct that. I believe that was put on hold.
Was it?
That was put on hold. There is support for a resource officer, but that was put on hold. There was discussion very similar to what Mark just brought up as far as the elementary and the regional looking at their budgets and being able to come up with some additional monies to put towards that. And also another idea was with Chief Chirk as far as hitting the drug facility, as far as maybe when you're talking about negotiating terms as far as percentage payment to the town, maybe that could be attached to that also, as far as some contribution towards a resource officer. Obviously impacts the entire community, the school system, and so on and so forth. So there are some fundings. But as far as the Finance Committee, and I don't want to speak out of turn here, but from what I remember and understand with our meeting, that portion of it was put on hold to see where that funding would come from as far as discussion. But Doug is right, there was definitely, I think, a feeling of support for the position.
I think the board is generally in support of the position. It's just how does it get funded?
Exactly.
I personally don't want to see us take the school resource officer and put it on the wagon of something that may not ever come about.
Right. Yeah.
So from my point of view, as much as that might help us in the future offset costs in the police arena and stuff, it's great, but I don't feel that if we try to plan on that, we're going to end up...
It may not happen.
It may not happen, and basically, I think that we need to address it now and set our oars in something that's real.
Clearly, John has had, the chief has had Brian Ravers over at the schools already. Schools have seen that there's real value, you know, as far as bullying on the internet, and I know they've done presentations and tried to, you know, taking care of that kind of stuff. And
that is the important thing to actually make sure is very clear, and I kind of felt that I was mistaken a couple of weeks back when I was talking about this initially, is that there's already an officer at the schools now. But what we're doing, and my understanding through my conversations with the chief, is what he's doing is he's essentially taking that officer off of regular patrol duty, putting that person at the schools, and backfilling that officer's regular duties with per diems. He's already added the equivalent of a ninth person on. What he's looking to do is essentially formalize that arrangement by hiring a person to put that, you know, hiring a person to fill that ninth officer slot, so that the person acting as school resource officer can do that free and clear.
That's a broad overview. The reality of it is we've authorized him to spend monies to make it happen, but when you fill with per diem, the cost of having that person be a non-person is at a bare minimum, it's, you know, a third less. And depending on how you look at the real numbers, it's probably closer to 50% of what it would cost to have it as a full-time person. So it's going to cost more when we cross that bridge to be a full-time person, because even at the lower cost, you're going to pay benefits, you're going to pay vacation, sick time, all that other stuff. And the per diem rate is not as high as what the lowest step of a police officer is at this point in time. So there's a savings of quite a few dollars in that aspect. So it's not dollars to dollars. It's when we make this jump, we're going to be adding another at least third of a person, if
without
not 50% of.
You're absolutely correct. So you're absolutely correct.
It's a lot bigger than just, you know, okay, we already have it. Well, you authorized them to spend it because the money was considerably less, and we had money coming in to cover a good chunk of that. Deerfield Academy has covered that person for almost all the time that it will take for this first year, because of per diem costs and everything else. And it's phenomenal for us to try it and see how it works. I get the impression from everybody I've talked to and heard that it's a total success. Now we have to negotiate how we pay for this thing, because I'm not in favor of forgoing everything else so that we can just add another person at this point in time.
So we just don't have the money as far as the town to increase the town's bottom line is what it comes down to. So hopefully the school systems will see the value to this and step up and figure out how they're going to be able to include that dollar difference
because
in their within right. their budgets mm-hmm.
and
is what the hope is.
Right, and the thing
I
is,
totally agree.
We
totally
can't
agree.
Do it with per diem people. It's just not feasible with the number. We'd have to put a whole bunch of more people per diem on, and then we have to look at contractual requirements and everything else. So it's really put a strain on the budget, on the schedule mm-hmm. in the police department. So it's not like, oh, let's just keep it the same way it was. We're at a crossroads, a precipice, where we have to make a decision, and we want to see who our partners are, because I, for one, think that partnership is the right thing to have. It's not something that I'm trying to say you pay your share of this because it should come out of your pocket. No, I think this is a reasonable expectation to have a good partnership. Mm-hmm. And it's not unlike what's happening with the ambulance service. It's a good partnership. You pay your share for it, and we'll make it all work. So,
if I may, just to make sure we're clear, we're looking for the schools to provide funding to fill out the rest of that position above and beyond the $30,000?
No. I think the town should have a fair, I mean, the school, Deerfield, and this is my opinion, we as a board have not discussed it. This is Mark Gilmore speaking, so don't get confused that this is something that,
sure.
that's the thing. My proposal is that basically the town ponies up some of that $30,000 or $40,000 that's going to be the gap between what Deerfield Academy has put into the gift fund and what does it really cost for that person to be that ninth person to come on the payroll. and have the remainder be split between the elementary school, Frontier, and the town of Deerfield as a partnership. So that basically we'll have a share, and each of the schools will have a share, and or some portion what they think is appropriate. The schools themselves aren't going to say, I'm not looking for an equal share, I'm looking for what they think is appropriate, and we'll kick in something to make it work. Because we are a personal.
Yeah, Mark, I agree. And I think we were looking at like $11,000 shortfall.
If we take the $30,000 from that we've received as a gift from the private schools, if we assume that the town is going to cover the benefits cost of this new position, we're looking at it between $11,000 and $13,000 all told, depending on where the person falls in the scale.
And I think that's a reasonable.
If our share is the benefits, that's fine. But
that's 15,
understand that
yeah.
that's a fairly chunk. You know, that's almost $18,000 on that position. So we're being very generous. I'm hoping the schools will meet us a little bit more in the 50% range, but I'll take it. I'll take anything I can to create a good partnership, because people get complacent if they don't have a dog in the fight.
So the expectation then, and again, I'm just trying to figure out where we're going with this, if at the elementary school in Frontier Regional provides some sort of monetary contribution towards this position, something more than a dollar, if they provide some sort of contribution towards this position, that it can stay in the budget, we can fill it, and we can move forward. Does that make sense? Is that
well,
what you're
looking
for?
I think to me that's the bottom discussion. That's the one where if they meet it, okay, we're from my point of view, and again, this is Mark Gilmore. We have not put a thing on the table to discuss it, but from Mark Gilmore, if they come up to the table and meet us with a reasonable amount of money, then it's a done deal. If it's not, then we got to go figure out how we're going to pay for this and where we're going to pay for it. I'm willing to go scrounge for the money for our portion, but I'm reluctant to say I'm going to scrounge for it all, but I'm pretty sure that the townspeople like the thought process. I think we'll do the thing.
Speaking for Jeff Upton and not the finance committee now, I agree. You have to see some good faith from the school systems. There's no question about it. Because the townspeople are going to look at this as simply just adding an additional police officer onto the force. And I don't want that misconstrued, because the resource officer can pay huge benefits for the school systems, all school systems that are within the borders of Deerfield here. So I think we have to be a little careful, but the funding is the key issue.
Right.
I don't think that the town can simply pick up the tab for that difference by itself.
Right.
I think there's going to be a good faith effort on the schools.
Right.
And understand that the police department has a vested interest in the fact that there's a commodity, a resource, that having that person available, not only in a school resource, but in overtime crunches and everything else, it's a benefit for the police department. So, you know, the police department may want to kick in some money and say, hey, we'll cut back on this so that we have this. You know, I think that it's time for us to start realistically looking at where we're funding and not expect it all come out of just more appropriations and more funding.
Yeah.
So that, and I think the chief's behind that thought process. I have had talks with him over the last months or so, trying to make sure that he understands that whatever's said isn't misunderstood, that this is, I think it's a great idea. I think it's great. I think it worked out well in the process, and I think that we'll move forward. And again, this is not any edict from the Board of Selectmen. This is not, and I'm open to suggestions as to how it goes.
No, I think there's consensus, because I think it's very valuable. We've talked about it. How things have changed, the use of technology, the exposure to drugs. Our kids are at risk. So I think we are feeling very supportive of this.
Yep.
And so, Doug, I guess we're dropping it back in your lap.
Well,
okay.
I think there's plenty of time for us to work this issue.
I know that Frontier's budget presentation was tonight. I believe it's tonight. I'm kind of why I was surprised to see Marty here, but Frontier's budget, I think, is tonight. The elementary school is working on finalizing their budget. It's very possible that once they finalize their budgets that they're not going to come back and readdress it. It's very possible that their response will be, well, we'll be happy to kick in some money, we'll just increase our budget by that amount. And in the case of the Deerfield Elementary School, granted, while there's some school, Chapter 70 money coming into the schools from the state, we're still talking about Deerfield money paying for this position, whether it gets funneled through the school's budget or not, whether it's our 51% going towards Frontier or not, it's still a portion of money going to pay this budget.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess I'm going to come back to the same thing that the schools can choose to say, no, we're done, we finished our budget, we have no more room, and they'll come back and say, no, forget it. If you want this, go ahead and fund it. Will the board's response still be, yes, okay, we'll keep it in the budget, we'll move forward?
I think we need to have more discussion on that.
Okay, fair enough. I will continue to pursue this.
Yeah.
I'll continue to pursue with the schools, see what I can do. I'll continue to have conversations with the chief about it, and I will continue to bring it back to you and let you know what I find out.
You know,
thank you.
I know a guy that used to have an expense account, and he was walking down Main Street in New York City, and the wind came down through the tunnels, and it took the hat off. And he put it on his expense account. I need a new hat. I was at work, and the hat got blown off, and it chasing it down Main Street in New York City, and I need a new hat. And they said, nope, we're not going to authorize you to get a new hat. So 4 months later, he submitted his fourth expense account, and at the bottom of it, he said, find the hat. You can make numbers do whatever you want them to do, and you can carry away whatever opinion or philosophy in your heart that you have. We're not looking for them to dig their feet in and have a fight over this thing. We're looking for a good faith effort to do the right thing for the town as a whole, because this is servicing the town as a whole. So if they come back and say, hey, just here's your hand and you make a wish in this one and do whatever in the other one and see which fills up first, I'm okay with that. I don't have a issue that, but at least I know where I stand. And when it comes time to pull that person for an emergency or an overtime shift or whatever, I'm going to ask the chief to pull that person rather than bring in overtime, because he's ours and all ours. So I hope they don't do that, because it puts us in an awkward position where we have to start saying, okay, we can't afford to carry everything, and let's figure how we can make this work, because I think we will make it work. I don't think the question is if, it's when, and how do we do it correctly. So I think we've beaten that one to death. Any other comments or concerns?
Nope. Doug, were the did you have other budget items, or do you want to just go right into the warrant?
I have one specific item, and then I just want to make a couple of really quick comments. A lot of questions in regard to the salary items. There's a number of employees who are at step 10. And the question is, will we be offering those individuals a cost of living adjustment to their salaries for next fiscal year? In other words, going from step 10 to step 10 plus, if you will. And if so, what would that cost of living adjustment be? I have two conflicting reports for FY 2017. One says cost of living adjustment should be 3%. Another says don't count on a cost of living adjustment in 2017 because Social Security is saying zero. So I have no clear direction to offer you. I know that last year we did 1.7. Previous years we've done 1.5 or 2. This affects perhaps, I think, two, maybe three people in the highway department, I think two people in town hall, one person in the police department. I think that's it.
the way the system was originally designed was when a person got to step 10, he got to what the fair market value of the position is worth. But there was a caveat put in there that the department heads would write the narrative to describe what that person did to deserve to be compensated more for the actions that they do. So I think that the smartest thing is to look at what the departments of heads evaluations of these people who have gotten to step 10 and take it under advisement to do it, because giving out a carte blanche, you know, percentage means you're rewarding the people that are there and just going to sit there and collect the paycheck forever. And I'm not accusing anybody of doing that.
Okay.
But if the department comes back and says, this guy's really valuable and, you know, I would put this person up for increase because he's carrying more than his weight, or, and I, we've never not given somebody a raise knowing that we did. You know, we didn't take away a raise from anybody, and some people may have needed that because they didn't meet expectations, but we don't do that. So I assume there'll be some moderate compensation, but I would like the department heads to consider writing a narrative to address those people that are in a department at step 10 and what their impression of them are and what we should do. Maybe send it to the personnel committee for consideration, and we'll sit down with the personnel committee and actually address this, because it's now been brought to our table for us to address in a monetary way.
I agree. We were trying to do everything merit-based rather than across the board.
And, you know,
trying to do that? Is that what you just said?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, that's the whole point of bonuses and whatever. I mean, it is, just to reiterate what Mark is saying, it is
right,
value-added, right. Merit-based.
Right now we're winging it. And, you know, we could wing it again like we've done in the past and just say, oh, just give it to them. I'd like us to see if we can work together and think through the process and come up with a number. And if you gave 3%, I'm pretty sure that the people that at step 10 would get more money than most of the people at step 2 and 3 or below 3. Just because of this discrepancy of how it stepped out. So I don't endorse giving a bigger raise to somebody who's gotten to the top of what fair market value is without us looking at fair market value to be in consideration. But if we've got, and we do have a lot of phenomenal people here, if we got them, it should be fairly easy to convince us that we fit somewhere between what the high number is and the low number. And I'm going to put this back on your hat squarely, is okay, I could do 50 researches and come up with 50 different answers of what I should give. My gut feeling is, okay, let's look at what we're paying the rest of our people and say, here's a percentage for the highest and here's a percentage of the lowest, and those people should get somewhere between that percentage of the highest and that percentage of the lowest, and let the departments help us figure out what that is, the way I'd like to see it. And we may end up just at the end of the day saying, it's too hard to do, let's just do X. And somebody picks a number out of their hat
Do you have the gist of the conversation?
I'm sorry?
Do you have the gist of the conversation?
No, but I'm taking notes.
Okay.
If you need help, give me a call back.
We can clarify it on Friday.
I'll clarify.
So let me feed this back to you and see if I got somewhat close. That you're not ready to recommend a specific cost of living adjustment for the step 10 plus slice of employees for the town. What you're looking for is to see a department head write a narrative or make a recommendation as to what they think that person should be getting, whether they should be getting either an increase to their hourly salary or a one-time so-called bonus or merit stipend, whatever you want to call it, and that those requests could be filtered through you, through the personnel committee for review and approval?
Well, I think they should go to you for to try to get them to be similar in nature. You've got everything with the exception of, I think, that we're not asking them to judge what percentage to give them. What we're looking is to say, okay, as this person fits in, unfortunately, I'm going to use a real four-letter word, step, because I don't like that word. But
I thought we agreed never to use that word again.
I promised I wouldn't, but I had to. But if you took the step before that and say, here's the high and the low, and I think this guy fits between that high and this low at 50% of that of that number, that would be a good assessment. Or 25%, or 75%. Because basically he's not, you know, he's doing as good as everybody else is, so he's not whiz bang, here we go, give him 100%, but he's not being carried around in a wheelbarrow by the employees of the town office here. And I use he as a generic statement, not to say it's going to be he's that bad or that good.
We can talk about it more on Friday on the budget stuff.
We're going to need to.
You can think about how you would like, what your questions are.
And my follow-up will be that I will be getting an update from the Collins Center to see where they're at with the class comp schedule. I will be speaking with several department heads tomorrow and Friday to get their feedback on how they would feel about writing a recommendation for those employees that are at step 10. As was discussed at the tail of a finance committee meeting a couple weeks back, the town is crippled in being able to provide merit reviews or merit increases because everyone knows everyone else's salary, and because it's public information. And because of that, one employee who's been working for 7 years doing a thing can look at the salary of another employee who's been working for 2 years doing that thing, and now the two-year person is making twice as much or a dollar more an hour than the seven-year person, and now you've got conflict on that crew because the one person resents the other because they're making more money. I don't know how to resolve that. I want to just make it very clear. I don't know how to resolve
that. You cannot resolve it and you can't fix it, but you look at it the opposite way. You've got this guy who's been there for 18 years.
Sure.
And by whatever reason, he's being paid less than somebody that's been there 2 years. Now, sure. I would hope that is because that person brought something to the table that we didn't have in the department. If it's just because he's taller or prettier or he has a beard or whatever the reasons is, it's not acceptable. But you have to be looking at this thing and saying, okay, I'm working beside this individual. We've got the same shovel in our hands, or we have the same pad of paper in our hands, and we're doing this thing, and this person is getting paid less than a person who's a new person in stock. I got to look at the department and said, how come? If it's because this guy takes 2 hours to do what the other one does in 15 minutes, it's a great value. And the person who's been there 18 years has to figure out what he's doing to make himself better.
Sure.
But by burying it, by saying, I'm not going to address it, we're not helping either one of those people because one's going to resent the other because, you know, the guy that's 2 years old is looking at this guy doing 18 saying, I'm carrying him. I'm carrying this weight because basically he's not doing as much work as I am, and I'm assuming he makes more money than I do if I don't know. But if I'm hired higher, that's the other side of that coin. It's people have an idea what they have to do to be better. Right now, there's no matrix. They don't know how to be better. They don't know what we're paying for. It's because you're here, because you show up every day for work. If that's the only reason we're going to get the pay.
I mean, we have a scale.
Yeah.
I mean, that's the purpose of the scale.
This might lead into my next topic of conversation. I've been playing with the staffing for the administrator's office. Right now, we have been staffing with a full-time administrative assistant, the executive assistant, and the town administrator. those three staff full-time, and that's been working pretty well. I've been looking at different possibilities and different options. One model I'm not necessarily, you know, entirely 100% set on involves a part-time HR person, not to take over or to do some of the work that's being done by the town treasurer collector's office. Right now, both Barb Hancock and Sarah Mission do a lot of the benefits management for town employees, including school employees. But a part-time HR person may be able to do employee reviews, to teach supervisors and department heads how to conduct employee reviews, to be present while those are done, to create an employee review process that not only allows the department to identify weaknesses and to allow the employee to understand why he's not getting the raise that somebody else might, but also to provide corrective action, to either encourage the employee to do better or slowly encourage the employee to find other employment on their own. You know, you're going to be down here at the bottom because you're not putting in what you need to. We've given you options for correction, and you can either choose to stay at the bottom of the scale or you can go and look somewhere else for work.
We had talked about doing a shared human resource.
Correct. And that's a conversation I'd like to continue with Mark Prohinsky, with Sherry Patch over in Sunderland. I think it could be a huge benefit for the three towns here in South County. But I think that the need itself is great enough here in this town, and the potential for benefit to the town exists. Go ahead.
I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt.
Not at all.
I thought you had finished.
Yeah, I'm done.
I think that you need to involve all the people. If you're going to have that conversation with the town administrators, you have to have that conversation with everybody who plays that role in the town right now. Because that becomes a guarded vestiture. I do the HR stuff and everything else, and if somebody takes it away from me, it makes them feel as if somebody is
not doing their job.
Okay.
So all I'm saying is get them all to the table and Sure. Let them all go in the right direction together.
Sure.
And again, I'm looking for the partnerships, because we've had islands in this town that has cost us a lot of money because somebody either holds all the knowledge and doesn't tell anybody, or it costs us a lot of energy and effort, which essentially boils down to money, because we don't have the knowledge that walks out the door, because people feel as if that's their right to keep it. You know, that's what makes them valuable. Well, I think that what makes them valuable is to get a system that really works and make it continue to work. And that's why I want to drive some of these conversations to go to, okay, have the conversations, figure out how to make it work, figure out how to minimize the amount of what we're doing. And that's what you're doing by saying, hey, we've got three people, we used to have four, we've got a half-time position, we can do this, we can put a part-time person in. Work those numbers so that we give the best product to the town and the employees across the board. And that's what you're doing. But we have to do it in the scale of everything we do, because we start another us and them or across the aisles, it takes us 3 years to get out of that do loop and realize that it's not beneficial to the town to have that conversation or to have that negative flow. And again, we've been working really well together, and I like to promote it to go further. And I think that with the right window opportunity with the performance appraisals and stuff, we can foster that thought process. And with your recommendations for changing things up and making it better, not necessarily full time in the sense of I'm going to do this now and forever. It's okay, we got an opportunity to change. We're down a person, let's see if we can work some deals around that and get a better product for it. It may not be a success, but at least we tried.
Okay. All right, I'll have a few conversations in relation to that, and maybe I can come back to the board with something a little bit more firm and solid. To reiterate, I wasn't thinking about taking any responsibilities from
current
staff.
Yeah.
What I was thinking about is providing a staff person who would do the things that we aren't doing now that would make our lives a lot easier, providing an assessment and feedback mechanism for our employees and thereby reinforcing the salary that they may or may not be getting. Essential.
And that would be maybe cut some legal expenses, you know, that we have towards the labor issues.
As soon as you start making rules, you're going to get more legal expenses no matter what you do. But the reality of it is we're doing it now. And
what are we doing now? What do you mean?
We have HR in place now because we address the issues, the fires as they show up. We're trying to make it better and again, this is what I'm trying to say is
sure.
We're not trying to single out any one person or anybody as to it. We're trying to make it better. And even what you proposed, once you train a supervisor to do what that HR person is doing with his people or her person that says, hey, you know, you're here because of this, this, and this, and that's you. That's all you. Mm-hmm. And I'll give you help in this, this, and this. You've got a convert that's going to take away a lot of this stuff that you got this part-time person doing, and we can move them on to something else. That's great. But understand, we've not given our leadership, us, the tools to make that HR be cultural. Be it mindset that we're doing these for these right reasons, and this is what we're trying to achieve. And if you don't buy into that thought process and come up with a better one, or as you said, you may want to be considering looking for a job somewhere else because we're not a marriage to you. We're not looking for the lone wolf. We're not looking for Superman. We're looking for people who'll do their job. And if you happen to be super at your job, then okay. But we're not looking for the one to go save the cats out of the trees and stuff on a regular basis and never show up to work. Bad analogy, I apologize, but it's the best I could come up on short notice.
I'm keeping an eye on the time, and there are two more things that I do need to get done. I hope it's only two more things, but I'm looking, and I think that's pretty much it. One thing that I don't know if you have it in your packet or not, and if you don't, I apologize, but we have received a letter of resignation from...
Yes, it's in here.
From our town moderator, Peter James.
Peter James.
Peter James has served as town moderator, I think, 37 years? And he has stated that this coming annual town meeting will be his last. In order to have this position, which is an elected position, go on the ballot, the board needs to formally accept his resignation and to notify town clerk to put his position onto the ballot, which if you wish to do, using whatever language you will, I'll make sure that it's sweetened up and given to Barb in the right form.
I make the motion that we, with great regret and extreme thankfulness.
Sadness.
Well, I'm...
I was thinking of not seconding it.
Well, if we can't get it to vote. And Peter deserves our respect in his request. I think Peter did a lot of soul-sucking. And I think that he's doing it for really good reasons for himself, and I hope that to be true. And that basically we should rejoice in all the years we had him.
I know. And, I just feel sad.
Yep. I'm going to miss it more than I can express,
He's so effective, and he's so organized and committed. I mean, we've been very lucky to have him.
Yep. I think that the one thing you can also count on is the fact that Peter will be willing to talk to anybody who's willing to consider the job and give great advice to it. So he's not... he's done a phenomenal job all these years, and he's never taken anything, been the best track for the town of Deerfield in his endeavors. And there are very few people that I can say has lived to the standard of being fair and equitable across the board. Well, I mean, he has a temper from time to time, but in reality, he's spot
very
on when he makes his decisions.
Very professional, Mark.
Yes. So, again, I'll make the motion to accept it with great regret and wish him all the greatness in the world because he deserves it. So,
I guess I have to second it, but it is really sad. Oh. Passing of an era.
Yes, it is. Definitely been a whole generation.
Is there, I guess we have to vote on it.
Yep.
All those in favor?
Regretfully, aye.
Aye. I guess we have to do it.
Yep. Yeah, I think it's the right thing for him. And if he changes his mind, I'm sure, I am absolutely positive that...
I wouldn't have any problem reappointing him.
There's a place for him.
I think he'd make a good write-in candidate. What do you think?
Yes.
You are awful.
Yeah. The last thing I want to just talk about is that I did provide you with a first draft for your information. Look at the where we're at with the annual town warrant. The first 8 or 9 or 10 articles, well, the first 6 articles are boilerplate stuff we've seen before. Article 7 is the, it's highlighted in yellow. It's a draft language for the use of building municipal building fund monies for those capital projects. That's, again, just draft. 8 and 9 are CPC monies and the funding for the wastewater treatment plant. Article 10 is something, and I know Carolyn talked about this at the CIPC meeting. Article 10 is very draft, and you guys need to look at it and figure out what it means and determine whether you want to include it on the warrant. It is changing Chapter 150, Article 2 of the bylaws of the town of Deerfield to allow capital improvements to the wastewater systems to be paid for by general appropriation, whereas right now, Chapter 150, Article 2 states that all capital improvements for the wastewater must be borne by the users of the system.
Do we have to decide to do this at this town meeting?
You don't, but it handicaps us. It means that any capital improvements to the system we have to pay for out of sewer reserves or out of sewer revenues. It means that we can't, unless we get a grant for it, it means we can't do the headworks project. It's also a conversation.
The headworks, we had enough money in the sewer reserves to do the headworks.
We can do the design for it.
Oh, I see.
And actually, that's something that's currently in progress, which is something that we'll take offline as a separate conversation. I'll call you more about that, but that's something of a concern right now. I'll give you time to read through that, and we can talk more about that on Friday. Article 11 is an article in place to provide funding for the headworks project.
Does 10 have to pass before you can pass 11?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. Let me throw a curveball at you.
Sure.
I've never done before.
Never.
In the article, it talks about improvements, repairs. It in no way does it talk about studying engineering design or any of that. So I'd like to have a backup article that allows us to pay out of town coffers for the study of the headworks project, because it will involve expanding the sewer system to other places in the town, and that way we could at least get the money for the headworks, leave the money that's in the capital reserve so that we could bond to do the repairs and build out, because we're going to need some money to secure money.
So I guess I'm a little confused. So what you want?
I knew I'd do that.
No.
I said it that way on purpose. What I'm asking is that we put in an article that would fall in if the town doesn't agree with this one, to allow us to take out of appropriation, town appropriations, the money to do the engineering, because it's not in that line item. It just talks about doing repairs, doing upgrades, and doing or whatever the words were, but it does not talk about doing design and expansion. And that's what this whole process is going to look at, is because the headworks is to give us the ability to expand this system out to the rest of the town.
So what is, now I have to go back and look at my, we just voted at the Capitol to do the 130,000.
Correct.
And that's the design.
The Capitol request was approved by CIPC, or recommended by CIPC, but there was, CIPC was silent on the source of the funds.
Right.
I think
that's, that would have to go through the
Committee. If the Board of Selectmen tried to get that money out of the general appropriation, that there would be some feedback based on the
correct
now pretty widespread notoriety of Chapter 150, Article 2,
right,
that the argument would be made that the money should come from sewer reserves.
Right.
I think that I hear where you're coming from in terms of doing the design out of, regular taxation or free cash or what have you. But again, I think that some folks would say it wouldn't pass the stink test.
We already did it.
We have in the past, yes.
That's where all this came from. And it,
which?
All these signs, there's a map here that talks about the sewer plan and how the sewer study was, and we put prox air in place, and that money came out of general funding.
Nobody was paying attention to Chapter
151 says operational repair of the system. These are expansion of the system so that it can be better served to the rest of the town. We, at that time when we did that, we were at the head end of, or at the upper limit of the expansion capability of the sewer treatment, because we had Oxford Pickle there. And
sure,
basically we were up against being fined.
Sure.
If we didn't do it, basically the town was going to be paying taxes, not the district. The town was going to be paying
the
fines
penalties
for not,
yeah,
doing it correctly.
Yeah.
In the same token, we're looking at, we're at 50% capacity. We could limp along and do nothing until DEP came along and said we had to do some modifications and changes to the building.
Sure.
But that would be modifications and changes to how we do business. That is in the preview of what is the best for the town. The operations, the strict operation and maintenance and repairs to the system is to be bored by the people that use it, but the improvement for the betterment of the town people is a legitimate betterment process. And all we're doing is figuring out how to label it, because if you do the first step where you're taking it out of that bylaw, you're doing the same thing as what my second step is you're paying
taking
it out
of the,
you're,
yeah,
paying it out of the,
I think,
so I don't know who's going to fight who, but it's going to be,
I think the argument will be made that if you don't change Chapter 150, Article 2, you can't do anything else. It either gets paid for out of sewer reserves or it doesn't get
done. Then send it to legal to get an interpretation of whether or not design and improvement of the facilities is captured in 150.
Again, the stink test would say that it is, that it's included in Chapter 150, because Chapter 150 says, including in particular capital costs such as repairs and improvements. And even planning for improvements can be considered an improvement.
I agree. There's an intent and purpose in that bylaw that I think has to be considered as far as when that was created and why it was done. And I don't think you can ignore the intent and purpose of that. I think that has to be addressed. So I think that study, in respectfully disagree, I think that study would be part of that money's as far as being treated as far as the sewer account.
As far
as the funding coming from that. And then to continue that, I think this town's going to need to have quite a discussion as far as the existing bylaw and where we're trying to go with that. There's a lot of people in town that are on septic systems and obviously have some concerns about all of a sudden changing this bylaw to include them in picking up a fee for the sewer system, and yet at the same time not having access to that service. And I think that's critical. If you're going to charge people a fee for something, they should have access to the service. If they don't have access to the service, I find it very unappealing to be paying a fee for that. And I realize we could argue this to the cow comes home, but at the same time, as I said before, we have not created an enterprise fund for all the people on septic systems, so when their systems fail, the town pays for them. Or when they go to sell their house and they have to have required a Title V done, and if they find out their system fails. So the replacement's not there as far as cost effectiveness.
Well,
and if you really take a look at the monetary value, if sewer rates go up for sewer users $400 a year, which, you know, I prefer not to have happen, obviously, for anybody, but if we have to face reality here, you do 50 years, what's that, $20,000 over that 50-year period? Well, when a homeowner has to, that's on a septic tank, has to replace their septic system, you know, right now, running tab is anywhere from 15 to 30, 35,000, depending on system. So I guess it all comes out to wash. Now, is there a value to the town? Yeah, I think there is. There's no question about it. And I think that needs to be discussed. And I think everybody has to look at this issue from both sides. As far as, obviously there's gonna be different opinions, but I think there's room to discuss this and come to hopefully some type of mutual agreement that's fair for everybody in town.
This also could be premature because we are currently doing the sewer rate study and we'll have that information back within a couple of weeks.
I could see us spending an entire evening or two on this discussion alone. Could you just make sure that John Pachorek Sr. gets a copy of that article?
I believe he's got it.
Does he?
I believe it's being distributed in leaflet form at Jerry's. I'm pretty sure it's out there.
Okay. Well, I mean, he is one that is willing to discuss this, so.
Sure.
Could also other people have copies of that, if that's hitting the table?
It's,
I would appreciate the
it's
copies of what?
It's a
copy of the articles, draft articles.
It's now a public record. All you have to do is come and request it.
There you go.
We don't have any. Once you put it on the table,
I'm saying if it, you know, obviously there is a John Church.
Well, only because of his years of experience, he can bring stuff to the table.
Right.
But
right.
And that's the only reason. It's just like we'd like to make sure it gets to Kevin too. That's just people who better have this and understand what it is. And just to counter your description, everybody can talk about this until they're blue in the face.
Mm-hmm.
The reality is that the town of Deerfield has to come up with some way of fixing the sewer issues that we have at this point in time. And it's extremely complex in the fact that there are so many integral fingers that lead into this thought process. To stop thinking about how to fix it because we have a disagreement between whether it's an article or whether it's a code, whether it's this, whether it's that. Mm-hmm. I think that it should be in there so that we can ensure to the people that we'll move on to at least the planning process of this. I'm not looking for us to fund the whole budget in there, but I'd hate to see us stumble on doing this study because we've done this piecemeal and we've taken three shots at the apple and failed three times.
Right.
And at times it was, and we've had this argument, you can go back and review these tapes over and over again when we took each one of those discussions and did, right. you know,
Well, I think we have to move forward, Mark, under the existing bylaw, what's existing now. And you may not look at a sewer study funding related to the bylaw. I do see it as related to the bylaw, and bylaw right now basically states that to do the sewer study, and I agree that sewer study should be moved forward, but that funding should come out of the sewer fund. And obviously there is intent and purpose there in that language, as far as why that language in that bylaw was
created
and approved at town meeting.
You're absolutely correct. And guess what? If we put it on town meeting floor and they vote to do it differently, it holds as much weight as that bylaw does.
Mm-hmm.
So we're not hiding anything. We're putting it to the townspeople for a vote to approve us moving forward with the process. I am not going to debate, and I can't debate because I really don't know that much about that particular item, and I rely on other people to give it to me.
Mm-hmm.
But if it says something in a bylaw which I think is harmful to the townspeople, I think it's our responsibility to give the town people the facts, let them vote them, and hold as much weight with that vote as we do that.
When you say harmful to the townspeople, who do you mean? When you say townspeople, from what my understanding is, there's about 60-65% of the townspeople on septic systems and about 30-35% on town sewer, roughly.
Okay.
I'm just saying roughly,
yeah.
And that stuff. So wouldn't the majority of people that's having an adverse effect on would be the septic tank people? And like I say, I'm not saying there's some value to this. I understand that, and I see both sides. But I just want to make sure that's brought forth so everybody sees the big picture here. I don't want this to come down to, look, we need to spend X amount of dollars on the study, and we need X amount of dollars to do a sewer upgrade, and everybody in town's paying for it. Bottom line, coming out of general fund. I think that's unfair.
If I can interject, there's two possibilities. One is that either we could proceed forward with the potential change of this bylaw, or two, we choose to leave the bylaw alone and proceed forward with an article to fund the entire Headworks project, about $1.7 million, purely out of sewer fees. And if that happens, it means the sewer rate in Deerfield will go up, rough calculation in my head, 20%, because we'll have to cover $100,000 worth of expenses annually to bond for this out of the sewer fees.
Mm-hmm.
And that $100,000 will turn our $527,000 budget for the wastewater treatment into $627,000, and that will be borne by the sewer users. If we can put on this warrant the proposed language to change the bylaw, we can put immediately after it an article to fund the entire Headworks project, and the only thing that will change will be the motion that's made. The motion will either be made to appropriate the money out of taxation or to appropriate the money out of sewer fees. I think that the conversation about changing the bylaw needs to happen because I do think it's a larger thing, but I'm going to defer to the board. It's up to the board to determine whether they want that article on town meeting.
It's great because that will keep the town meeting moving along.
Yes.
Well, and it will address the Headworks, and it won't.
May I ask a question? If this was only going to cost $500 or $1,000, would we be talking about changing the existing bylaw?
Nope.
Would we be talking about taking it out of general fund instead of the sewer?
Nope.
So the only reason why we're talking about this to change bylaw and as far as general fund compared to sewer fund is because of cost of it?
No.
Well, that's what we just talked about.
No,
if it's only going to cost us $1,000, we wouldn't be changing it, and it'd be coming out of sewer fund.
With all,
it would be coming out of general fund, and we'd be talking about changing the bylaw.
With all due respect.
Yeah, okay.
You're not even in the same book. You're talking about two numbers that really are insignificant in the thought process, comparing it to something that's really significant to the townspeople, and I'm sorry that I can't convince...
We've had this bylaw in place. It's been adapted since 2002, I believe.
Yes.
Since 2016
2002,
now. Yeah. All right. So we've had 14 years here where, according to what I've heard from some people supposedly in the know, town-wise in the area, we have one of the lowest fees in the state as far as sewer. Mm-hmm. Why weren't we paying more for those 14 years in planning purposes into that fund for a more realistic sewer rate fee, so we wouldn't be in the bind of having a limited fund. We would have more additional money in that fund.
It is a very pointed question. It can't be answered.
Well, it can be answered.
No,
you can't answer that.
I can't answer it. It's the same reason we don't have the money to do the school.
People didn't want to pay the
money. We didn't do the right thing in the right place. Mm-hmm. It doesn't change. Jeff, you're right. You're 100% correct in everything you've said. But in the realization of it, we still have to have the conversation.
Right.
Opinion is great to have it, but I disagree with you because I have a lot of facts that I don't want to share right now.
Yeah.
I don't know them to be truthful, but I know that there's a lot of things that were discussed over the last 14 years that told me what the townspeople wanted to do.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I don't know that that's a fact anymore.
Right.
I don't know that is a fact, but what I'm telling you is that if we lay out what we're going to do, and it includes where the funding stream comes, how much is going to be bored by the sewer users group, everything else, I think that it'd be good.
I respect what you're saying, Mark. I guess I'm just stumped on how you can charge townspeople a fee for a service that they have no access to. They don't have an option. They have no access to that service. And I have to rely on my own means to take care of my sewage. And when my system fails, I'm going to have to rely on myself to replace that system at a fairly large cost. I can't count on other townspeople to contribute to my septic system and my cost. So I guess that's why I did the comparison as far as an increase in sewer fees over a 50-year period compared to me placing it. Pretty much comes out even. So I just don't see the rationale and the justification to charge people a fee for a service that they cannot access. And I'm not, and like I say, I'm not stupid about this. I realize to town-wide there's some value to that, and I'm willing to address that.
Yeah, but
at this point, I don't understand how.
We can't give you the how, Jeff. What you've said is correct. There's absolutely no question that every point you've hit is valid. But is it the significant contribution to the decision-making process? And I can give you examples all day long, and you're not going to buy it. So let's not try to convince each other that we think one is right. I'm not on the sewer. Right. I have the same argument you have, that I have to rationalize in my own brain.
Mm-hmm.
And when I go to sell my house, I've got to spend all that money to do Title V. I understand all that.
Mm-hmm.
It's still in mind. But the little old lady that's sitting over there, and she never had any kids, pays for that school, whether she gets to access it or not.
Is what, me too?
Yeah. It's the same thing, though.
At the same time, there's a difference. No, it's not the same.
It's close.
The state mandates the school in the formula as far as the funding, and we don't have input on that. The town is mandating this, and we should have input on
that.
The
town is considering it,
mm-hmm,
and how to address it. Because the state mandates the permit for those buildings out there.
Right.
And if we violate it, we all get to pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
Whether you use it or not, you get to pay for it.
Right. But we have a bylaw that's existing with intent and purpose behind it.
You've said that, and nobody's arguing that point.
Yep.
Articles 16 and 17 in your draft agenda, or draft warrant, are there. Article 16 is there because the planning board is planning on taking up a change to the use schedule to allow self-storage warehousing in the C1, C2, and industrial zones. That's going to be forthcoming. I expect there will be another article coming from the planning board because they're considering making changes to the minimum lot sizes and frontage requirements for properties, I think in particular in the RA zone. I'm still not sure of that, but I think we'll find out a little bit more at the next planning board meeting on March 7th. I expect that they'll request a placeholder article at the very least. Article 17 is kind of funky. If you remember last year, town meeting approved the economic development plan for the Deerfield Economic Development and Industrial Corporation. That economic plan allowed for commercial development in the industrial park. Through a lot of legal wrangling, Dedek's attorney has determined that the town meeting will need to request that the general court enact special legislation to change the mission of Dedek to allow for commercial development. Okay. This hopefully will be a very quick, very simple thing with no presentation. It's essentially doing the mechanism that we need to do to get Dedek on the right course. But it is something unusual, something special, out of the ordinary. A lot of the other articles down to Article 24 are expected. Article 25 is there at Carolyn's request. That is funding that was appropriated previously to the FRCOG's efforts in relation to the Kinder Morgan pipeline. It's funding to assist the town of Montague. And I'm not sure if I've got the language on this right, Carolyn, so we'll take it offline and you can help me make sure that I've got that right. To assist the town of Montague as intervener in relation to the DPU deliberations. But we'll figure that out.
Actually, I think we need to increase. Well, we have the $8,500 that we've already appropriated, but I'd like to add another $1,500 to that.
To make it $10,000.
Yeah, to make it $10,000. So okay. It would be transferring the $8,500, but it would also be
an additional
raising.
$15,000.
Yeah, just because I think they're so far they're paying about $26,000.
Can you back up on that and explain that to me again, please?
Why? What?
As far as the article again?
The article is to take money that was appropriated to the COG to help review us in our endeavor for
intervener status,
for the planning thought processes for the Kinder Morgan pipeline. It wasn't to pick a fight or it wasn't to stop it. It was to be an evaluator and fair,
mitigate the impacts of it.
Mitigate the impacts if it was to come through. And Carolyn's asking for us to take that money from the COG and give it to the town of Montague for their endeavor to stop the pipeline.
No, they're intervening. We were going to split the intervener cost for the moratorium, to fight the moratorium for Berkshire Gas. Crystal had advised us not to file the intervention papers, and Montague went ahead without us and did that. And so this is to contribute to the expense, because the moratorium is obviously impacts us, and we were going to do this jointly anyway.
Did you talk to Chris Vival about this?
Right.
Because if he's telling us to stay out of it,
no,
by us giving money to them, we're doing
that's why we're going to check the wording, because the wording is to assist with the expenses of the intervener status. It's not for us to be listed as an intervener.
But it's not. It doesn't matter if we're listed or not. Is if we go on record of giving them money, we are taking that side. And I think Chris Duvall is to stay out of it completely and stay with the fact that the Board of Health
I will get a statement from Cristobal for this.
I feel a little uncomfortable to spend taxpayers' dollars, Deerfield taxpayers' dollars, to support Montague's endeavor. And I'm not saying I'm opposed to the endeavor whatsoever, but if we're running a separate suit
No.
With a lawyer, well, I know, but as far as information, if we're on our own on that other,
What Montague has generated for expenses is to hire expert opinion to go through Berkshire Gas's paperwork, confidential paperwork, to review it, to show that the moratorium is not legit.
Right, but I have to agree with Mark, doesn't that get us involved where we're not supposed to be going?
We need to get legal opinions on that.
Well, yeah.
We need a statement. We need to clarify that.
Yes, right, we will get a statement from Cristobal.
I would be very careful with that.
We need to get a statement from our town council, too,
and to
make sure we're clear.
Yeah, the big issue I would have with that is the fact that how do you track the money after you turn it over to the other town?
Because it's a specific purpose and it goes towards their expenses. We can certainly show receipts.
I think if you give them the money, you're never getting it back.
Right.
They're going to spend the town of Deerfield's money first.
If they only spend $12,000, $2,000 there.
They have already endeavored $26,000 in expenses. So we could show the bills.
Article 27 and 28 are in relation to Lake Street Development Solar Project. 27 basically...
26.
I'm sorry, 26. Yeah, that's the...
Mosquito article. We had not agreed to put this on the... we had more further discussion before it goes on the warrant. I wanted it as part of the Board of Health budget. So if the money is going to be a regular, stable board expense...
Okay.
Board of Health expense on a regular basis.
I'll put it wherever the board wishes to. You asked to have it
well,
in
Mark
the
and I,
Board of Health.
Mark and I had not had further discussion on this.
Right.
Okay.
We'll have.
So what's the consensus then?
We haven't had further conversation.
Okay.
About it.
So it's
we'll
there
pick
as
it
a
up.
Draft.
We'll pick it up. It's,
yeah, right.
It's a placekeeper, so it's a good.
Okay.
You can go away fairly
easily. It's just
easy.
That we need the stability of a regular line item.
Sure.
And it needs to be able to be adjusted just like the snow and ice budget or whatever, depending on the circumstances. We haven't gotten that far, I agree, but I'm just saying that the point is it should be under the control of the Board of Health, and it needs to be a regular reoccurring expense, not to be put on the warrant article as if it's not an annual expense.
Okay. I'll defer to the board's direction, of course.
If it's going to be in an article, I would rather it be under the Board of Selectmen because we at least have meetings. We can discuss it when it goes out. It's the Board of Health. We don't normally sit and have a discussion in the Board of Health of where it's going and what it's doing, and when it goes
Mark,
out,
we
is
can
an
agree,
expenditure.
Mark, we can agree that it can be, well, certainly... You're not going to be able to request further money from the Finance Committee without having discussions anyway. So if that's going to be, we can certainly work that out to meet on that regular basis to discuss the mosquito thing. I just feel it's appropriate to be in the Board of Health expense and not subject to a warrant article every year as if it's like a new expense. Needs to be a regular expense.
Carolyn, if it was proven, I would agree with you. But this is a trial process to figure out, does this thing really work? And I think that it deserves the scrutiny of going through instead of being a automatic, I got this money. It needs to go through the vetting of reporting and, hey, this seems to really be working.
Okay. I mean, if
it's
that's the way, I mean, if you feel strongly about that, that's fine. I just want people to understand that this is not a one-off money. This is, this is part of a long-term program.
You've made it very clear in all of your discussion that it's going to be this plus more money.
Right. I mean,
this is just the tip of the iceberg for what you want to establish. And I don't disagree that it may be necessary. It may be necessary, but what I want is I don't want it to get hidden in the line item that basically automatically renews without somebody looking at it strongly and being reported in conversation.
If you feel comfortable that we have a handle on it, you don't mind it going back into the board.
Not at all. If it becomes a strong commodity, like...
All right, that's fine. I just don't want to have to argue about it every single year when the purpose is we're having a long-term plan, hopefully, mm-hmm. to address this issue.
We never had an issue with that.
Okay, all right. And then let's not argue about it.
Sorry that you think it's an argument. I think it's a discussion.
All right, no, that's fine.
Articles 27 and 28, so numbered right now, relate to the solar project on River Road. One is ratification of the net metering credit purchase agreement. We may or may not need to legally do this, but on the advice of town's council, I've included it on the warrant just to make sure that we've covered our bases. Article 28 is a placeholder article with the anticipation of a structured tax payment agreement coming forth from the Board of Assessors and an agreement with Lake Street Development Partners. That will have to go before town meeting before any structured payment agreement can happen because of the term of it, because it's a 25-year agreement. That is being negotiated. The Board of Assessors are on that. Number 29, Article 29, I've highlighted also. This is similar to something that was done last year, which pulled certain properties, town-owned properties, and made them available for sale. We are, hopefully within a couple of weeks, we will be putting the properties that the Board of Selectmen have control over now, putting them up for sale. And that will help to feed our free cash numbers next year. It will help to reinforce, you know, our financial standing. There is apparently a one-inch thick stack of properties that Dick Kalaszewski has identified. Some of them are thin, tiny slices of land. Some of them are more significant. And I would like to go through a review of those properties with him to determine which ones that might make sense to dispose of. Of course, bring that list to you for your review and consideration. But I put this article on town meeting floor as a placeholder so we can continue to do this each year to get rid of strange pieces of property that the town will have no use for.
Well, it makes sense to put it back on the tax roll somehow.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And Article 30 pays your salary.
Two things. Yes. Back on the Article 29, I think that you need to widen your scope of evaluations to department heads, because they may be thinking of needing land or wanting land or...
Absolutely. Oh, I don't disagree
just
at all.
That you and Dick are great, but they may be thinking that, you know, we got to do something with the non-sewer issues, the things that aren't sewer related, so I don't have to talk to the judge. But they may need sites, and they may want to put things aside for them, and that little sliver land may be a great place to put a police car or something of that nature.
Yep. I will, with your permission, I'll pass that on to all department heads once we do a cursory review of certain parcels. And I would like to expand that out to, because it's a really good idea, expand it out to also the fire districts.
Yep.
And possibly the water district.
Well, send it to the ambulance service.
Well, yeah, absolutely. No, I was thinking any department head. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Again, the pieces that I've seen are either landlocked. Yeah. They're up on the ridge. They're landlocked. They might be good for a woodlot. Or they're tiny, strange, thin quarter-acre or eighth-acre parcels that are not buildable by any stretch, but an abutter might want to buy it and add it to their yard. And I think the last count, there's something like 40 separate parcels that are out there. I would suggest no more than four or five.
I want to see the list because in 2005, they took 2.5 acres off my property. I want to make sure it's not some sliver they're going to try to sell
later on.
Make sure
it didn't get put in the wrong place.
In Article 30, we should do an evaluation of the moderator's salary. We've been trying to get Peter to take more money for the last 10 or 12 years, and he just flat refused to do it. And the numbers we have are common around the local area, that's fine. But if it's much higher to have somebody come in and do this job, we're going to have to look at getting somebody to take his place. And his good graces aren't here anymore, so we should look at, are we competitive for getting somewhere.
Actually, we do need to look at the selectmen's salaries too, because if we can't, I mean, did you take out papers, Jeff? Did you take out papers for the vacancy?
On the advice of counsel, he declines to answer.
My concern is that we just aren't going to have people volunteering for this job.
Well, I think that you may have a few.
I think we need to increase the selectman's salary so we at least have maybe somebody that will take out papers at least.
I have not taken it.
Well,
we can look around. We can do an evaluation of all of them.
It's a tremendous amount of hours, and you want to attract people that are truly interested, and I think we have to pay a little bit more money if we're going to have people come and spend the time, especially younger people. I mean, Mark, I'm getting tired.
If we could get a stipend for a younger person by age, that would be great. But I got news for you. You crank the money up, and I can tell you there's going to be two people that are going to show up because they want the money. They're not dedicated to the thought process. So it's a mixed bag. Again, that one will work for you or against you. We can look around to see what everybody is paying for all of them.
I can do a cursory look at other towns in Franklin County and see what other people are doing,
particularly
for the moderator and for selectmen. And I'll go through all the
I would go through all of them because reality
is... we're not getting younger people in.
Sure.
And
we can't cherry pick. We can't say we're going to do it for one and not the others.
Fair enough. Let me do a review. That won't take too long, and I'll see what I can come up with.
I'm just concerned that we're not going to get people to do this.
Merit-based.
I'm pretty tired.
Okay.
I'm done pretty soon.
So other than asking
no one seems
for...
to listen.
Other than for asking for wet ink signatures on this appointment paper, which I will make sure you get at the close of the meeting, and reminding you to please take a look at the New England Patient Network agreement for review, and look again at the town meeting warrant draft.
Did you send us that in an email?
Which?
The
host agreement?
Yeah.
I think I may have a few days back.
Because I got news for you, even with my glasses.
It's extremely
I don't think
small.
That's going to work.
The copy that you got in your packet tonight, though, is a little larger.
Read that, Mark.
Okay, so I can read that.
This right
yeah.
here.
Yeah.
Yep. You can have this back then.
Okay, yeah. Yeah, that's a lousy copy. Right.
Thank
Absolutely.
You.
And I hope to have a more complete budget for you to review on Friday.
Okay.
I look forward to seeing David again.
All right.
That's all I've got.
All right. Take a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Any further discussion? Very or none? All those in favor? Aye.
Aye.
Okay.
Thank you very much for chairing the meeting.
And you've got, Mark, you've got your end.